फोर थ्री टू वन स्टार्ट।
Good evening, everyone. We are again with you with another webinar from ROSA City Chapter. Today, it's webinar on the decision making in the proximal tibial fractures. So we have very eminent guest faculties with us, other ROSA faculties in the Jodhpur City faculties. So I'm sure we'll have a very good case presentation discussion today. So first of all, I would like to invite ROSA president to formally inaugurate today's webinar, Dr. Arun Vaishya, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Rahul. Good evening, all my guest speakers, especially Dr. Shushrut and Dr. Kashyap. Also my friends, Dr. Kishore, Dr. Pratik, Dr. Hemant, Dr. Nand Kishore, Dr. Rahul, everybody. To tell you, Dr. Shushrut and Kashyap, because you are new to our ROSA. So this year, we have decided that we'll be holding such type of webinars, in each city. So as we can reach to all cities and all the faculty members, they can showcase their cases. They can have the opportunity to speak in front and share the dais with eminent faculties like you, and they can share their cases and learn from you the tips and tricks of trauma. So this is, in continuation of that, we have second webinar. First we had Ajmer, now this is Jodhpur conference, Jodhpur webinar. So now not taking much opportunity, not making much of time, and I formally inaugurate and welcome all, and hope we have a very good learning.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
So,
thank
you. From the ROSA side, Dr. Rahul Garg is coordinator for this webinar, and Dr. Hemant Jain is moderator. So, not taking much of the time, over to you, Dr. Rahul Garg. Initiate the proceedings of today's webinar.
Thank you, sir. Good evening, everybody. I welcome all my eminent faculties from ROSA, from national faculties, and our own ROSA faculty. We have eminent faculty like Dr. Shushrut Babulkar, Dr. Kashyap Pardeshna. Dr. Shushrut Babulkar, I will give you a very short brief CV. He is a founder member of International OTA. He is president of Trauma Society of India. He is vice president of NAILS, that is National Association of Interlocking Surgeons. He is a task force behind lower limb AO trauma regional chief. And he's for Center for Joint Reconstruction Surgery. He is chief of Shushrut Institute of Medical Sciences. And Dr. Kashyap, he is an eminent orthopedic surgeon from Junagadh. I would just give a very brief he's a well-known AO trauma surgeon from Junagadh. He's practicing since last 20 years and he's at Junagadh, Gujarat. He's a good practitioner. He practices trauma, arthroplasty, arthroscopy. He's a faculty at AO Basic and Advanced Courses and faculty for many states and national meetings. So over to you, Dr. Hemant. I think all others, you can introduce them as they take their talk. Over to you, Hemant, as my moderator, Dr. Hemant Jain.
Thank you, Dr. Rahul, and good evening, everybody. As Dr. Rahul ji has already introduced our guest faculties, Dr. Shushrut sir and Dr. Kashyap sir, we'll first take the talk of Dr. Shushrut sir on multiplating in proximal tibia fractures. Over to you, sir.
Okay. Thank you very much. First of all, let me... share my screen. So I wish to thank, of course, ROSA for inviting me and asking me to speak on this topic. So I want to take this opportunity to thank Arun sir, Rahul Katta, Rahul Garg, and my friend Hemant Jain to invite me over, and Dr. Kashyap Adeshana to support me in this as a co-faculty. My brief is going to be breaking the ice for next few cases that we are going to do. So I'm going to make a brief overview on what proximal tibia fractures are and how we have changed in last few years in terms of decision making, and why we should consider not only one plate, but consider multiple plating. So we will look at this. Historically, if you see and if you remember, if a fracture like this came to us and we were given lots of option of various plating, and when we saw various plates in our armamentarium, we wanted to go ahead and do a lateral plating conventionally, and we fixed a plate with all those screws going in, trying to correct, looks all right under image intensifier, looks all right immediate post-op x-ray. But this bicondylar variety of a fracture was so amenable to collapse at the fracture site, resulting into genuvarus deformity, unacceptable genuvarus, which was like this, and it was a disaster. So let's look at very typically what classification we used to learn and follow is this Schatzker's classification. And the most dreaded, of course, is type 5 and type 6, which is bicondylar with increasing amount of comminution. So that's a dreaded fracture. Schatzker himself thinks that type 4 is a more deadlier fracture. But with advent of CT scan, we know that it's not only two planar fracture that we think of, but it's anterior fractures, posterior fractures, coronal fractures. So it was divided into anterior plane, posterior plane, and again, anterior and posterior planes were divided into medial and lateral. So this was the classification which we thought of based on 3D CT reconstructions and CT tomograms. And so we divided that. So that was the article which was published by Chang. And then, of course, Schatzker himself also revisited his own classification. Now that was further classified based into imagining a plane which goes from fibular collateral ligament to medial collateral ligament, dividing into unequal entry and posterior parts, but defining coronal plane fractures. So this was Mauricio Kufri who revisited Schatzker classification, and Schatzker himself and Kufri came out with this classification, which also directed us where to place the plates. So that's the importance of this classification. And that's the importance of doing a 3D CT reconstruction, CT tomograms, so that we know how to consider doing a CT classification, where to place plates, so that we do not have any collapse in undesired position, and patient gets a better outcome in terms of functional mobility. Why it's important? Because our patients, Indian patients, want to squat down, they want to sit cross-legged. So if we are able to reconstruct and maintain the tibial articular surface in a desired way, as we achieve immediate post-op, and if we maintain that with support of multiple plates, then we are able to offer our patients better squatting ability, better kneeling ability, better cross-legged sitting ability, and even if osteoarthritis, secondary arthritis sets in, a better ability for easier conversion to total knee replacement. So that's the importance of all these fancier classifications which have come up. Let's look at what are the unstable patterns. So if there is a huge total medial condyle fracture, type 4, Schatzker, that's the most unstable. Though it looks very innocuous, very benign, that's the most difficult fracture to control from collapsing further. Please remember that. How does it look on the CT scan? That's how it will look. You will see a depression there right in the middle, and you are able to identify it. So that's a very unstable fracture. If you look from the posterior side, there will be a tilting of spike. So this spike is very characteristic of this unstable pattern. Why it is important is when you take a posterior medial approach to reconstruct and put a posterior medial plate, this spike you have to reconstruct. So you have to look horizontally in the articular surface and on the spike when it notches and fits into the V groove where it should go. So it's a bi-level approach. You have to fix the notch and you have to also see the articular surface, whether it is good anteroposteriorly and lateromedially, because that notch can fit, but it can still be tilted. So also look for anteroposterior view, lateromedial view, and fitting of the notch in the posterior medial approach. That's an unstable pattern. If there is a comminution which is thrown in the intracondylar notch, don't worry about PCL, ACL. We don't want to fix it primarily unless and until it's a singular intercondylar fragment with gross instability of the ligament. If it's comminuted, don't worry about primary ligamentous reconstruction. Just reconstruct your fracture fragments. On CT scan, you will look like this. That's the notch which I'm talking about. If it is comminuted, it's very difficult to identify where that serrated notch will go. Don't worry about this comminution. If the patient becomes symptomatic because of ligamentous instability, do it 3, 6, 9 months later for that ligamentous reconstruction, either ACL or PCL or both. Don't rush into primary ligament reconstruct in this unstable pattern. The moment there is a posterior medial fragment and comminution in the coronal plane, that's how it will look. Again, a very typical fragment and tilting of the spike, comminution, posterolateral comminution, posterolateral fragment, posterior medial fragment. You need a different approach. You need multiple posterior coronal plane fixation, multiple plating in the posterior part of this. Importance to reconstruct the posterior slope, which is 7 degrees classically, which we also consider in doing a knee replacement. We give tibial plate that 7 degrees slope. In some processes, it is inbuilt. In some, you have to reconstruct that slope. Why? Because our patients want to have 145, 150 degrees of flexion. Our patients want to squat down. So to have that terminal flexion, this posterior plating, posterior buttressing, and to reconstruct that posterior slope in these kind of fractures is extremely important. So that's an unstable fret pattern. We have to recognize that. What we used to do is, for example, this patient who came to me, bicondylar fracture, treated like treating a birbal, making a birbal ki khichdi, lateral plating, trying to control a medial fragment. He reported to us 4 months post-surgery because there was no way patient with a lateral plate trying to control medial condyle will work. What do we do in such a case? So there are lots of issues, wrong side plate fixation, inadequacy, choice of wrong implant, etc., etc. Whether medially we need an additional plate, we operated on him. We took out a lateral plate. We did a medial plating. We did a lateral plating. We tried to reconstruct the articular surface. Of course, it's not as good as it is desired. This was 2006 case. We wanted to do a good articular reconstruction, but that's the best we could do. That's 1 month down the line, 2 months down the line, 6 months down the line. See that at least the articular surface and at least the axis is maintained for a better conversion to arthroplasty. That's 1 year down the line, 2 years, we removed the implant. That's his range of flexion. Now, after reconstruction, reconstructing that posterior slope, which you can see on the lateral view, he has a good flexion. That's what we want. That's what we want for at least a better knee arthroplasty, easier knee arthroplasty for a joint replacement surgeon. And once you remove, of course, TKR is inevitable, but a better bone base is offered. That's the idea. So when we consider only a single plate, which was used earlier and which we did for years together, how does it work? It works as a cantilever only on one side. What happens? It doesn't work like a post and lintel because we want to reconstruct the entire articular surface. Maximum forces go through the medial side because 90% have a varus deformity as an arthritic forthcoming. So we want to reconstruct lateral as well as the medial side. We want to have a post and lintel system. So we want something like this, which is a classical bridge reconstruction. If we don't do it, what will happen is, if you remember, we have to balance the weight. We can't have terminal weight. We have to balance it. If you note it there, he has balanced the weight by putting one more weight which is medial to him, nearer to him, proximal to him. So that's how you balance the weight, like doing a medial plating. If you don't do it, you have to support it by your hand. Even if the strongest person will need some support, we can't hold it for a longer time. As you will go along, the strongest person will also need some kind of a support or some kind of a medial anti-weight to support that cantilever. So we are talking of a strut or some medial support. And then when we evolved in the technology and when we evolved having more and more implants, we tried with proximal humerus. That oblique screw, which is also called as a strut screw, would pass obliquely and hold distally the medial condyle, hoping that it will not collapse, hoping that it will not result into deformity at the fracture site. It works if it's a single condyle on the other side. But if it's comminuted and if it is unstable, even this strut will not work. That's the problem. So we, of course, tried with on one side, but is it mechanically better? No, mechanically a stronger option than a single plating is, of course, having a double plate. Mechanically stronger, better ability to have early weight bearing. So lots of approaches were offered with more understanding of all these comminution patterns of proximal tibia. If it's an anterolateral quadrant, we can look at lateral parapatellar or the typical hockey stick. Now this will form your workhorse. This will be always there in most of the, now 95% of the cases, you will always need this, irrespective of having only a lateral condyle or not. If it's a posterior medial quadrant involvement, you want a posterior medial approach. If it's a combined fracture, lateral and medial condyle, you will need a anterolateral as well as a posterior medial approach. If it's a posterior medial condyle, you can either do a posterior medial approach or an extensile across the popliteal crease, very dangerous approach, but it's described and we should know it. Posterolateral approach for a posterolateral condyle, it can be either doing a fibular osteotomy if there is an extensive comminution. If there is no comminution, I prefer either a Frosch approach or a lateral femoral condyle osteotomy, Kufri's approach. I don't do it, but that's been described, so I just mentioned it for you guys. So let's look at how we consider doing various approaches and where should we consider. So in addition to your standard anterolateral plate, when should we do medial plating? So medial plating, if you want to do, it can be an anteromedial plate or it can be a posteromedial plate, because it can be in the anterior quadrant or in the posterior quadrant. When should we do anteromedial plating? So that's the fracture. Again, if you do a CT scan, you are looking at two fractures. There is a fracture on the coronal side, posterior medial fragment. You see that anteriorly, there is a huge lateral fragment. So you will need a anterolateral plate. And there is a single medial condyle fracture, single condyle. Though there is some comminution posteriorly on the anterolateral surface, this condyle on the medial side is a singular major fragment, also seen on the x-ray, very obvious. So what do we do? Wait for the fracture blisters to settle down. I am not going to go into details of that. We will consider that into fracture cases when we do. But that's a lateral plate, your workhorse of proximal tibia. And that interesting plate which I have put is a anteromedial subcutaneous plate. Now, there was a period when we used to do a fixator medially to avoid that collapse of medial medially to result into varus deformita at the fracture site, which I showed earlier as a complication. So this is a temporary internal fixator. Wait for 6 weeks, 8 weeks, 12 weeks till there is good medial consolidation. And this troublesome plate, which some patients say that it is palpable medially, sir, iski takleef ho rahi hai, we can remove that plate. So you remove that plate after 8 to 12 weeks. In this case, 6 weeks, I removed it. Good bony consolidation. It will not collapse further because you have your lateral plate, your strut screw. your medial fixator job or a medial internal fixator job is done, you have achieved absolute. So not absolute stability, not relative stability, a combination of absolute stability. That's the recent concept in this comminution articular surface fractures. What you want to have is absolute stability at the articular surface level. You want to have a relative stability in diaphyseal metaphyseal junction for some time. So that's absolute stability that you have achieved, and it will result in good in good consolidation, maintenance of whatever amount of valgus you want to maintain. Good posterior slope is maintained, what you want to achieve, good bony consolidation. So once you achieve that, you will have an excellent functional result as well. So you, once you reconstruct anatomically, your functional result is going to follow you good anatomical result. Posterior medial plate, my friend Lou, I love his approach. What he does is, he's the one who talked about the concept of posterior lateral fixation. So inverted L, based medially. So you primarily fixed your posterior medial fragment, and you can extend this L in the popliteal crease way to posterior lateral fragment. It's a difficult approach, not impossible, not dangerous. And most of the posterior lateral fragments which lie in the posterior side, even if comminuted, can be tackled very safely by this approach. He prefers a floppy lateral position, so patient is supine. The non-operative side can be flipped on the other side. You fix the posterior medial fragment first by taking a posterior medial approach. That's a fragment to be attacked first, because if you do lateral fixation and then consider doing a posterior medial fragment, it will never reduce. So always posterior medial fragment should be the first fragment to be reduced and fixed. Even if you want to do a temporary fixation, reduce the posterior medial fragment first and then go on the posterior lateral surface or anterolateral fixation. So that's how you do. Clinical example, that's a fracture, that's the CT scan which is showing posterior medial fragment and a posterior lateral fragment there. A posterior medial fragment plating is done by a simple posterior medial fixation. So that's the approach which I'm talking of, and that's how you do a posterior medial fixation and a anterolateral fixation. Very simple to do. That's how it will look at posterior medial fragment, posterior medial plate first, and then the classical anterolateral fixation. And it will continue to maintain your articular surface till it consolidates well. Now there are various styles of plating. For example, again, this is a major medial condyle, a dead medial plate. You do not have to strip the medial collateral ligament. Your plates sits on the medial collateral ligament. Do not denude the comminuted fragments. Do not disturb it. If you want, you can remove this medial plate early. So that's a way of dealing with a major intact medial fragment. That's how you do it. Another example, medial plate, a longer lateral plate. Always try to prefer a longer lateral plate and a shorter medial plate. You don't want to have equal size plates, because otherwise you are developing a stress riser at that level. So don't consider doing equal size of equal height of plates. Another quick example of doing biplanar fixation. Here I have tried to catch the posterior fragment by passing an anteroposterior screw and holding it together for this fragment which was placed anteriorly. More area-wise options. Let's look at this. So this was a coronal fracture, posterior medial plating, and a posterior lateral plating. So this lateral plate will always go obliquely, because I have used a inverted L approach, which I have showed you the loose approach. I have extended it into popliteal crease. Once you reduce the posterior medial fragment, put this obliquely. You don't want to see all the way that area, because that's how it is fractured. That's the posterior lateral surface. That's how it is seen. You just support it. You just raise it If at all you want to do, you can see it by a submeniscal approach laterally and elevate it and see it and just support it by this oblique plate, and you will maintain this posterior slope is maintained. You have buttressed this posterolateral fragment and you are safe to go. What is the risk of injury of the antetibial artery? You have this safe zone. If you see, you have this safe zone to push your lateral plate from ear to ear. So that's your safe zone, which is almost around 7 millimeter distal to your articular surface from here. So that's your safe zone. So don't worry about it. You can go from here and push your plate laterally, and you can see in Frosch approach, you can actually see this area. That's how you see it submeniscally. It is important to do submeniscal. It is important to know submeniscal approach, because if it's a posterolateral fragment, almost always your meniscus will get entrapped in the fragment. You will need to take it out. You will then need to reduce your posterolateral fragment, then put it the meniscus back into position. If you want to push it and the meniscus is entrapped, it will never get reduced. So it is better to do a submeniscus arthrotomy and then reduce this posterior meniscus approach. Very innocuous looking fracture. I suspected something nasty. We did the CT scan. So the patient had this posteromedial fragment and a depressed posterolateral fragment. If you see, that's all depressed. The lateral tibial condyle typically is a convex structure. So if it is showing like this, the entire thing is depressed. How do we do it? We try to analyze how far it is gone on the 3D CT reconstruction as well as the tomogram. See how it is depressed. The convexity is gone. It has become concave and it is showing a bruise there. It is just above the fibular head. What do we do? What we do is go and fix the posterior medial fragment, which is the first fragment to fix. That's how you do it. And then go laterally, erase and raise the submeniscus, erase and raise the lateral meniscus, and like a raft, contour your reconstruction, normal reconstruction plate to fit the lateral condyle above the fibula, and pass your screws in the reconstruction plate. They will automatically fall subarticularly and hold that articular surface which you have raised like such. And that's how it is. Very simple to do. That's how I have placed the plate, elevated the lateral articular surface, Frosch approach, and pushed my semicircular lateral tibial plate and passed these raft screws to support the elevated articular surface. No need of grafting. Compound grade 3, suspected neurovascular involvement, articular surface, metaphyseal diaphyseal fracture, bad looking on CT scan. That's how it looks. What do? Span it, allow the neurovascular structure to be relaxed, allow your vascular and plastic surgeon to help you, span the joint, put a longer lateral plate, a shorter medial plate, wait for some time, and then that is your definitive reconstruction. A longer lateral plate and a shorter medial plate will continue as your definitive fixation. Of course, this is always a problem. If there is a lot of comminution, even if you do a lot of raft screws there, even though you reconstruct the articular surface, there will be some osteochondral dissolution on radiology. But as time will go by, it will reconstitute itself. The patient will be happy. The movements will be good. Functionally, patient will be happy. So don't worry about it. So multiple plating, why, when, and how? Why should we do it? Because it is going to add biomechanical strength. It is, of course, fracture dependent. You have to analyze on CT scan. CT scan is a must. You cannot operate on these proximal tibial fractures. Even if the X-ray is innocuous looking, do a CT scan, you will be surprised. Bicondylar fractures will have vulnerability to sink and displace. When should we do it? City will demonstrate you. They will tell you the pattern. They will tell you the where the combination is. And once you decide where that major other fragment is, that will be your longer plate, either medially or laterally. How do you do it? Anterolateral is your workhorse. It will be added with either a anteromedial or a posteromedial or a posterolateral plate. That's the proximal tibia people. So that's Shastkar himself. And that's Kufri, who has modified Shastkar classification now. And you have, of course, you have to update every 6 months. The concept of proximal tibia is changing. So even that's Shastkar himself, who talked to me 1 year back. And let's see what he has to say.
Share with you my thoughts. I don't think we're going to succeed improving the mechanics. I think we need to put all our efforts into learning how to control the cascade of fracture healing, how to manipulate it, how to accelerate it. I think we have reached a level of excellence in terms of soft tissue handling, in terms of understanding fractures, in terms of reducing and fixing. But issues remain. That's my take on the future.
So I think, friends, proximal tibia, even today, it's disturbing Joseph Shastkar at the age of 92. We are very young guys in front of him. I think I have tried to break the ice. Now it's open for case discussions. We should thrash each other. We should have some active discussion. Over to you, Rahul. Any questions on this? I am absolutely open for discussion. But I think as we will go on the cases, I think we will evolve with more and more questions and answers and more discussion on this. Thank you.
Beautiful talk by Dr. Shushil.
Thank you, Shushil, sir.
He has done a total justice to this proximal tibia, a metaphor where we need, how do we have to fix this take-home message of yours, which is very important for us, is that first go medially. Fix the medial fragment first. Otherwise, if you start with anterolateral or posterolateral, then probably medial fragment you may not be able to get. So this is the take-home message. Any other, anybody who would like to
ask? Rahulji, I think we'll discuss later. Rahulji, sorry to interrupt.
Okay.
I think we'll discuss with the cases later on. First of all, let us finish that talk. So I'll invite Kashyap sir for his talk on posterolateral approach.
Right.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Rosa and Ortho TV, for inviting me for this program. It is a wonderful lecture by Sushrut sir. There's so many, you know, he has combined engineering aspect, even the political aspect of supporting by others. But it was really nice. Breaking the ice and putting a medial plate is very important in a complex fracture. That was his message, and it is very well hammered in our mind. So I'll be speaking on a very small topic. Dr. Sushrut sir, of posterolateral window in cases. So my talk is to how to do that posterolateral. Is my voice clear?
Yeah.
Okay.
You are audible. Good. You can go on full screen.
So yes, I will be speaking on posterolateral fracture. Very small subset.
Dr. Kashyap, your voice is breaking. Yes, Dr. Kashyap, your voice is breaking. I think because of the bandwidth. If you stop your video, I think.
I don't have it.
No. Your. You can take it on the full screen, sir.
It is on my side. Should I stop, sir, and do share again?
No. You can continue because it's breaking. Your voice is breaking.
Okay. See, I have already sent to you and Hemant. If you can run, I can keep on speaking, and that will.
Okay.
We can see your screen. Your voice is breaking, sir.
So what will happen?
Try stopping your video.
Yeah. And if you run it from your side,
and then
because I already send it to you for that purpose.
I'll
run it.
You so start sharing your screen, Hemant, after opening Dr. Kashyap's.
One second. I'll run his presentation.
There is 39 Mbps upload download on my side and 25 upload, but still I don't know why it is.
Hey, we can see your screen. Just you stop your video, sir. I think that will work.
Okay, but do you have my presentation ready?
Yeah, I'm trying.
So that will be easier. That will be easier. So won't be any issue.
I've already opened your screen.
Yes.
I've already opened
and
your.
Then I'll stop my video also at that time.
I have opened. Can you see my screen?
No, start sharing.
That Zoom screen is not coming now to me. One second, I'll start sharing.
I'm unable to see your screen.
Now can you see everyone?
It's coming now.
Yes, your screen sharing has started.
Yes.
Make it a full screen mode.
Yeah.
Down
how
there.
To do that, sir?
Down there is a. There are four options on the bottom bar.
In the right corner, if you see the Zoom, there's a button, sir.
If you slideshow.
Slideshow. Bottom bar.
Otherwise, click on the slideshow. And play.
Dr. Ahmed, in the corner, you see the third point that is slideshow. You can start that. It will automatically be full screen.
Down. Yes. Down. Right side.
The hidden icon.
Last symbol.
Just before minus or sign, you know, there is a minus sign of the zooming.
No. Niche.
Bottom.
Yes. Got it.
Well done.
Kashyap sir, please start.
आपका वो बटन एक बार दबाओ फिर वो अभी फुल स्क्रीन नहीं हुआ ओके राइट नाउ ओके सो दिस इज द क्लासिफिकेशन दैट वी फॉलो राइट नाउ इज बाबुलकर सर सेड एंड हिज फोटोग्राफ्स आल्सो विथ लियो इट इज द लियोस थ्री कॉलम फिक्सेशन कंसेप्ट दैट वी यूज नाउ सो इन दैट देर इज एन लेटरल कॉलम देर इज ए मीडियल कॉलम एंड देर इज ए पोस्टीरियर कॉलम द पोस्टीरियर कॉलम इज अगेन subdivided into posteromedial and posterolateral. So it is a very small subset of this posterolateral column about which I am going to speak how to approach that. So you can approach that by three ways. You can come from the lateral aspect by doing subapsial approach. You can do FROS approach, or you can also go from medial to lateral as it was shown in the last talk, reverse incision, and where you can reach up to there. But there is a very small subset of, next slide, please. Next slide.
Yes, sir.
So I think there was, so this is the case. If you look at this case, then there is a posterolateral isolated depressed fragment, which probably you cannot approach from lateral aspect also and medial aspect also. So this type of the cases where you need to go posterolateral approach. Next, please. Next slide, please.
Ahmed.
Yeah. Next slide. So, yes. So if you look at this slide, where there is a postural lateral column, where there is a small triangular area, that triangular area you cannot reach from the medial aspect by going through the reverse L incision. And that was a wonderful cadaveric demonstration by Thirachai and his group, where if you have a fracture in that part where it needs to be buttressed, then this is the place where you need to put your do your postrolateral approach. Next, please. So this is that paper which I was speaking about, in which this is a postrolateral tibial fracture, how to buttress it. So whether you go reversed L postromedial approach or you have to go directly. So it is a very small part, say about 40% of the postrolateral area. If you look from the tibial spine to lateral edge of the tibial plateau, it is a 44% to 81%, or the area which is drawn under the orange arrow. That is the area where if there is a fracture, you cannot effectively reach either from the lateral aspect or from the medial aspect. In that case, you need to do this approach. Next slide, please.
Hemant.
So this was the case which...
I have turned the slide, but it's because of...
So there is a postrolateral depression. Sir. This is how that patient was operated. So this is the how you can put your small plate through this window, and you can elevate those fragment. You can see under vision submeniscally, and you can buttress it from behind. So I'll be describing a case in which I'll go step by step and incision to incision. That also I will compare with the cadaveric slides, and so that you can have a clear view how to go ahead in this approach. Next slide, please. So this was a female, 50 years. She fell down from a table, and this was her X-rays, where we can see a small postrolateral, say like a Waller-Barton kind of a subset in a postrolateral area. We got a CT scan. Next slide, please. In a CT scan, there was a split depression type of fracture of a postrolateral part. So if you see, say everything else is intact, it is only postrolateral aspect which is broken. And in a coronal, in a sagittal view, if you see, there is a small articular part also, and there is a wall part which has gone down. So this is the fracture where probably you will not be able to do everything from all other approaches. So these type of cases, we will do the postrolateral approach. Next slide, please. So this case, we operated with a wrist plate. We have put on the postrolateral aspect, and we could achieve almost 100% articular reduction. So how to do this? This will be followed in a next series of slides. Next slide, please. So this is how we position the patient. We position the patient in a semi-prone, and I operate from the opposite side, and C-arm is kept on the same side of the operated limb. Next slide, please. So the landmark which you can feel are major two landmarks. One is the fibular head, and another is the bicep femoris tendon, which is a very prominent tendon, thick tendon, which is attaching on the fibular head. Even if the patient is fatty, these two things you can always palpate. And this is how the marking, if you can see, there is a fibular head, there is a bicep femoris, previous years. Then there is a common peroneal nerve, which is drawn with the zigzag line. And there is an incision, like, you know, rail type incision. This is how my incision will go. Incision will be starting just behind the fibular head. It will be straight in the line of biceps, and it will be, you know, centered over fibular head, say 5 centimeter above and 5 centimeter below the fibular head. Next slide. The superficial or common peroneal nerve is absolutely superficial. The moment if you cut the skin and subcu, you immediately see that there is a peroneal nerve. So we have to be extremely careful when putting an incision, because in orthopedic style, we many a times you put, you know, very deep incision at a one go. But here you have to take very much care. You have to keep on palpating your bicep femoris, and just behind the bicep, you will find a white, beautiful common peroneal nerve as it is seen in the operative picture. And once you see that there is a peroneal nerve, you don't have to dissect it. You have to just identify in the first step of your surgery. You don't have to do anything to that nerve. You don't have to go anywhere lateral to it. Your whole window or all your job is just medial to it. But the first step is to identify it, protect it, and then you start working on the medial aspect. Next slide. So once you see your peroneal nerve, then you start working on the medial aspect. The next medial structure which you will see, the lateral head of gastrocnemius, which is covered with the fascia, wide glistening fascia. You have to retract your lateral head of gastrocnemius on the medial aspect. Sometimes the retraction is tight. So the small tip is you can do some facial release, like there is a small facial release done in the upper part of the gastrocnemius lateral head. So you can make it little lax, and then you can easily retract it on the medial aspect. Next slide. So once you retract your gastrocnemius on the medial aspect, the next structure in a deep portion, if you put your thumb, you will be definitely able to palpate your posterolateral tibial condyle, so that you just have a sense of where you are going. But then the next thing which you're supposed to do is you have to release or erase the soleus very carefully from the posterior aspect of the fibula. So you start making a window there. You start releasing your posterior neurovascular structure. So you, from the posterior upper fibular head, you start erasing your soleus muscle, say about 4 to 5 centimeters. Once you erase, then your window will enlarge. Next slide, please. There is a very important and very constant structure, which is a lateral geniculate artery, which always will be there. It is directly arising from the popliteal artery. So you have to identify that. You have to identify it, ligate it, and then you have to cut it. So it is very important to see that, because if you don't identify it and cut it, then there will be a lot of postoperative bleeding and hematoma, because it is a direct branch from the major vessel, popliteal artery. Next slide, please. So these are the cadaver dissection. Once you open this window, once you cut your lateral geniculate after ligating, then on the floor, there is a popliteus muscle. So popliteus muscle is a triangular muscle. It is starting from the muscle part is on the medial aspect, and that the tendon is exactly traversing over this posterolateral tibial condyle. And then it goes laterally to just, you know, insert just below the lateral femoral epicondyle. There are some people who says that they cut that, they tag it, and at the end of surgery, they repair it. But I don't find a need of doing it. Rather, you put a small sling under your popliteus, then you just mobilize it up and down, then you will have a working window there. So in this cadaver dissection, they have said, once you cut your popliteus, you are directly visualizing your posterior tibial plateau. Next slide, please. So this is how you reach to the posterolateral. Once you reach to the posterolateral aspect, then you have to just do a submeniscal arthrotomy. This is this slide is from some other case of mine also only. But if you can see the articular cartilage nicely after the submeniscal arthrotomy. So once you see that, you try and elevate it. And if you need, you can put a graft under it if it is a very thin subchondral area. If it is a big subchondral bone, then no need to put any graft. But you just elevate, hold it with the K-wires, and then you put your plate on that. Next slide, please. See, this is how with the punch, the middle this depressed portion was reduced, and over that this wall fragment was closed and held with the clamp, and then temporary K-wires were put and the reduction was checked under IATV. The lateral play two was nice, and then we proceed for the further fixation. Next slide, please. So these are the pictures after putting a plate, and this is how I want to show you how you can play with the popliteus. So starting from the second, if you see the first operative picture from the left, you can see the popliteus just going across your plate. Once you lift your popliteus up, then you can see the whole plate underneath, and once you put it, pull it down, then you can see the articular part. So after, I have tried 2-3 different plates for this area, but this plate, the one plate which is we use it on a wrist volar aspect, there are many plates for the volar aspect of wrist, but this plate which goes over the watershed line, that is a very perfect sitting of this plate over the posterolateral plate too, and you can easily put your two cortical screw on the metaphyseal region also, that is enough also, and to go down there is a danger of entry tibial artery. So this is a very nice plate to fix on this area. Next slide, please. So this is IATV picture at the end. Next slide, please. So this is the same slide which was also, this is a very important slide, which was also demonstrated in Babulkar sir's presentation. If you see at this cadaver in the middle, so there is a lateral genicular artery, and there down there is a TA, what is written is a tibialis anterior bifurcation, which is going into the interosseous space just below the fibular head. So there is a window of say 4-46 mm plus or minus 9. So around you have a space of working about 4-5 centimeter in between. So if you have put a very big plate and the many screws there, then there is always a chance that you might have injured anterior tibial vessel. So in the middle picture, if you can see, just above the plate, there is a glimpse of plate over which you can directly see the anterior tibial vessel. So it is very close to it. So you have to take very much care. So two things very important for a neurovascular. One is ligation of lateral geniculate and identification of anterior tibial vessels. Then you can keep on working. If you have not seen any of this, then there is a chances of postoperative bleeding and many complications. Next slide, please. Again, stressing on the same point. If you look at this coronal images of the MRI, which we often see for knee injuries. So if you look at the leftmost image, so there is a vessels seen on the MRI. You see the joint line where the joint is, and exactly there you see the lateral geniculate vessel. Just below that, for around 3-4 centimeter, there are vessels going down there. So it is a very small triangular area which you have to identify, and you have to work between that, and you can go ahead and do plating in that region. Next slide, please. Next, please. Next one.
I hope, is it coming?
So, yes. So these were the final x-rays on the left side, and the right side, we can see the later follow-up on the later months where the fracture was nicely healed and articular cartilage and the plateau was maintained till patient recovered. Next, please. So the take-home of my lecture are the posterolateral approach is a very necessary tool in treating the tibial plateau fractures. A very small subset of patient would require that, and there is a very small window to work through, and we must know the local anatomy and limitation of this approach, because this approach is not an extensile approach. So knowing the anatomy of that area is very much imperative to going for this approach. Next slide, please. Thank you. I'm really sorry for the technical glitches on my side, but thanks, Dr. Haman, for saving me by presenting from his side. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. Very nice and illustrative presentation. And it did a very daring approach, all vessels and nerves nearby, and really a small window. So I think let's go straight to the case discussions, because there is a limit of time, and I think we should fix the limit of discussion per case so that everybody gets to present. Around 8 to 10 minutes, we should be finishing the cases. So first,
Can I add one thing? Okay. So yes, very nicely told about a plate, this distal radius plate, which can be used on posterolateral aspect, right? And nowadays, I think Synthes has also introduced few plates, area specific, posterolateral and posteromedial plates Synthes have introduced. They are also good value, I think. So
that's
fantastic.
True. There are many plates coming on the way, but what happens with the other wrist plate? The trajectory of screw goes across, while the plate which we use,
this is 90.
Because that this goes 90. Yeah. So the other plates actually, of the case which I have shown, the screws were going across. So that will not serve the full purpose. Till we get a good anatomic
also,
plate of Indian, then this is the option we can use.
It was a beautiful presentation by Dr. Kashyap. I think, Hemanji, you can...
I'll now invite upon Dr. Arun, sir, our ROSA president, and our ex-HOD to present his case.
Yeah. Thank you, Hemant. Thank you. After very elaborative talks by Dr. Shushrut and... Dr. Kashyap, just a minute. I don't know where it has gone. Sorry, I'm taking much of time. I don't know where it has gone.
Hemanji, Dr. Kishore is ready, then we can take
one. So I'll come back. So somebody.
So, okay, sir. I welcome Kishore, sir, our ex-HOD and my chief, our unit head, to present his case.
Hi, everyone, and I hope I am audible and visible.
Yes, boss.
Yeah, so this is our medical college, and I will be the opening batsman as far as cases go. After the lovely talks and wonderful talks from Shushrutji and Ardishnavji, and this is my first case. This is a very innocuous, as Dr. Shushrut said, that innocuous fracture, looking benign looking fracture, that's called type 4 Schatzker medial tibial fracture. So here it is, this case. The 25 years male, obese, and with a twisting injury while dancing, pain, swelling, and inability to bear weight. X-ray shown. So very simple. Actually, it looks like there's a simple medial condyle fracture and we can just fix it. And what next? What are the investigation we should do? Just now we have learned that we must go for CT, but what was actually done? No further investigations were done, and this was operated by the primary surgeon Now, is it acceptable? Yes, we know that it is not now because we have already been taught by two teachers. So it is a very flimsy fixation by the primary surgeon, just two screws. Although we should know that this medial condyle is so benign looking, but it is not actually, because the posteromedial fragment may be there. We have to get the CT done all the time. Every time we should get the CT done for the these kind of cases. And this kind of fixation is not acceptable. And what we are expecting? We are expecting that they will fail. The medial condyle will go into varus. It will collapse. The articular segment will not be in good position. And this is all what had happened. After 3 months, patient is still unable to bear the weight. Obviously, why and what are the problems? Yes, it has gone into non-union, it has collapsed, it has changed the shape, the congruity is changed. So what should we do now? Well, fortunately, patient came to us after getting the implants removed elsewhere, and this was the situation. So, what should we
do? So, now we can, sir, we can take comments from other faculty now.
Yeah. So, Dr. Pratik, what would you like to do now?
Sir, I will further see. It looks that articular cartilage, articular surface has been destroyed badly. There is a lot of combination as it was in fixed and malposition. So, it's showing the varus. And I see it's the joint surface is attenuated. So we can get further investigation. So whether there is a articular cartilage is preserved or not, or what is the status. So I would prefer an MRI in this case first, and let's see what MRI reads. So based on that, I'll further decide.
So what we did? On examination, yeah, a lot of varus, of course, as we were thinking that maybe the ligamentous injury or the collapse because of the varus collapse, we don't know. Look at the situation, it is sagging. So the CT scan, we did the CT scan as well as MRI, as Dr. Pratik suggested. But MRI showed that all the ligaments were maintained, and CT findings, as you see, is the medial condyle fracture. And with the varus collapse, non-union. So what next?
No. Sure, I have a question.
Are you around, Dr. Nand Kishore? What would you do?
We will go for the posteromedial plating in this case and fill the deficiencies with the bone graft. As you said that the ligaments are intact.
Yeah.
And only medial condyle is comminuted and posteriorly segment is seen in this CT scan. So better to go for posteromedial plating and SOS bone grafting.
So are you sure the posteromedial plating would be good enough, or this anteromedial plate would also be required?
I don't think that two plates can sit on this anteromedial or posteromedial. If the large segment is posterior, then we should go for posteromedial.
So, well, this was the situation. Tibial slope is totally reversed. And what was our target? I mean, the available options, as he said, that we should go for posteromedial plate. But of course, what we needed to do was to open it completely, remove the fibrous tissues, and put some bone grafts, fill it up, and make all the biology good, and followed by good reduction. After good reduction, we need to do the retention, whichever way we want, whichever we were trying, wherever the place is, and whatever we can do. And we went for this posterior medial approach, which we have discussed already. Dr. Shushrut has guided us for that. And we tried to do the joysticking and try to do the reduction by this correction of slope. And because it's very important to not only do the articular congruity, which is of course very important, but we need to look at the stability of the joint we have to look for the mechanical alignment and of the joint. Without that, we are failing in our duty. So we try to correct the slope. We corrected the alignment, and did this posterior medial approach. We had done the bone grafting, good bone grafting. We took it from elite crest and followed by restored the mechanical axis. Varus collapse was also corrected. We tried to put one plate, but it looked like that another plate would be required because the posterior fragment, which was coming, was not coming up with that. We put two plates and fixed it nicely. And this is all the post-operative axis work. So whatever best we could do after so many months in non-union looked pretty good, pretty satisfying. And this is the final follow-up. This is the range of motion. It was pretty good. Good range of motion. There was no instability. This is the X-rays at 3 months follow-up. And here you see patient can stand, bear weight, good alignment, good limb axis, and good range of movement you can see. So what is the take-home message? So do it right first time. Complete evaluation is very important. Salute the CT. Don't take isolated medial condyle lightly. We must know that it is a big chunk and it can be a part of the tibial spine. It can be associated with the vascular injury, maybe even the nerve injury. And even the coronal fragment leads to the subluxation of the joint. The femoral condyle inflection goes with the displaced coronal fragment. So it's very important to, when you see the medial condyle, single medial condyle, just follow it up, go for CT, get complete evaluation. Then don't forget to maintain the limb alignment. Very important. Mechanical axis, joint stability, and not the least, joint congruity. And as Dr. Shushut shown us so many cases, pamper the soft tissues. Soft tissues are so important. Unless until soft tissues give green signals, don't go ahead with the fixation. Get the green signal first from soft tissues. Don't ignore rehabilitation. We have always been teaching our students 3 R's, reduction, retention, and rehabilitation. So rehabilitation is very important. Range of movement, very important, because there's a range of movement of the joints which will make the cartilage repair. Cartilage is repaired by the range of good range of motion. And finally, go wholeheartedly. Half-baked dish is not good. So just opening it and putting some bone graft and nothing like that. Just open it, remove all the fibrous tissue, do good bone grafting, and do the complete work. Thank you. Thank you very much. Just a
Yeah. Thank you very much, sir.
May I add a few things in that? Hello?
Background sound.
Yes, Kashyap sir, please go ahead.
So that was a wonderful end result, Kishore sir, because the alignment of patient post-operative, the clinical picture, it was very nice. The most alarming and the important thing, we need to recognize this injury on day one. This is not a regular case of a proximal tibial or a bicondylar fracture or a medial condyle fracture. This is an anteromedial with the reverse slope. This is a small subset of patient where the mechanism of injury is varus and hyperextension. This patient often has an associated posterolateral corner injury. If you go back in your slides, in a CT scan, there is a small tip avulsion of the fibular collateral seen on the fibular aspect. So if there is a varus which is left and that that lateral collateral complex is not repaired, then these patients have a varus lurch in the posterolateral corner laxity. So if whenever we see a reversal of slope on the lateral view, so in that case requires an anteromedial correction of deformity. And often these cases are elderly. This case was young, but often these cases are elderly. So varus hyperextension injury is a different subset of patient. There are little different principles of it. There is a one very nice paper which everybody must read on that. And that is in my case discussion. I will show you what that paper is. In these cases, I would suggest we need to put a tricortical iliac crest graft on an intromedial aspect. And I would prefer an HTO plate, which a single plate can fix your all the thing on a primarily. There is a fibular collateral avulsion on day one that also needs to be repaired. And if this patient has a varus on opposite leg, say if this patient has a genu varum primarily on the opposite limb, then this is the time where along with your medial fixation, you need to overcorrect it like a medial tibial condylar osteotomy, or you can, in one of the cases I have done, medial condylar temporary KVR fixation, added HTO to it, then put a graft and put a HTO plate. So this is a very different subset of patient. Whenever we see a reversal of slope and a lateral X-ray, then the plan of treatment doesn't follow the regular tibial condylar fracture. There are different set of principles.
So you have used one suture anchor, I was just saying. Is it for the middle MCI?
Yeah. While doing that, we got a little bit of avulsion of MCI, look like. So we use the anchor to fix it up. Good catch, Pratik.
If anybody who is, admin, can stop the sound from Dr. Jagdish. Yes, it's done. Yeah.
Remove him, Mr. Dr. Jagdish Godara. He is not the faculty member.
All the participants other than the invited faculty, and please leave this platform and rejoin yourself from Ortho TV link. Thank you. Thank you.
So, Dr. Kishore, I have one comment. Actually, in some of the pictures, when you are showing the varus deformity, there was a scar of incision in the suprapatellar region, parapatellar and suprapatellar region. So, for the screws, why this incision was such long?
No, I didn't get you.
Show the examination pictures.
Yeah, that must have been done by the primary surgeon. You mean to say like that?
Such a long incision or compound fracture?
Sir, you can go back to your slides. Kishore, sir? Yeah. You can show your slide. Clinical picture, that slide.
This one you wanted?
No, earlier one. Pre-op picture. Clinical picture. Yeah.
So, why there is that scar?
There is a big scar on that. Ideally.
Parapatellar and
suprapatellar. Yeah. That's right. That's I can. I really don't remember now.
Another thing, the question basically important is, nicely done case after 3 months. Suppose this patient presents fresh.
Yeah.
What sort of plate, whether dual plate or single plate, or what approach should be used? That is the important thing. Because every time we are not getting the patient after 3 months.
Yeah, that's right. Now, Dr. Kashyap has already mentioned that since it was a reverse slope and it requires a different strategy, that's a different issue. But then if we see that we get the CT scan done, and if it is a posterior medial fragment, if you find that it is a posterior medial fragment, of course, the posterior medial plate is the right answer, because it is the shearing of the posterior medial fragment which is more dangerous than anything else. And because it takes away the femoral condyle with it in its fragment, especially when it is flexed. So we have to be very cautious about this fragment. And the absolute indication for this double plating is the shearing fracture, the posterior medial fracture of the in the coronal plane, apart from the anterior lateral, if it is the double plating has to be used. Otherwise, the single plate on the posterior medial part, if it is a big posterior medial fragment is there, or if it is anterior medial more, we can just put the anterior medial.
Any faculty would like to do it with the single plate? Anyone from the faculty member? Or everybody agrees with Dr. Kishore?
Sir, probably, sir, can we go to the X-ray, please? First X-ray. Then we will be better informed. First X-ray. Yes, sir.
Dr. Kuldeep, you want to say something? Please go on.
Yes, sir. So, seeing the lateral view here, I think a CT scan would definitely show multi-fragment, and a single plate will be very difficult to take care of this fracture. So probably we will have to apply a posterior as well as anteromedial plate.
It's always there, you know, that there is a difference or discrepancy between the X-ray pictures and the CT scan. And that's the reason why we have to consider the CT scan as a workhorse for our proximal tibial fractures. Mm-hmm. And that's why I mentioned in my take-home message, salute the CT. It's the CT which is the key for the decision-making.
Right.
Rahul boss. So the point between two plates or one plate for these fractures is decided by CT definitely. But if you see the apex of the fracture, and if you are able to put a plate over the apex of the fracture, you can get away with one plate. But if you are by some means, either because of the fracture personality or because of the exposure, if you are not able to put a plate over the apex of the fracture, then you need to support it with the two plates. So the point is that if you see that there is an apex of the fracture, medial plate too, if you are able to match that, as Dr. Shushrut has showed in his talk initially, if you are able to do that and put a plate over the apex, you can get away with the single plate in these fractures in primary stage. Absolutely. Coming to secondary stage, after 3 months or 4 months or 2 months, as they have applied two plates, and you can see that in this pre-op X-ray, the slope is actually acceptable. It is not a reverse slope. In the lateral X-ray, which is on the side on the screen right now. But after revision, the slope is reversed, because while do posterior plating, when we elevate from posterior medial, we try to reverse the slope. So rather than going posterior medially, we just treat this as a high tibial osteotomy, which is medial opening wedge. But the difference is only that we don't take our lateral part of the osteotomy towards the fibular head, but we try to exit our osteotomy somewhere between the intercondylar notch. And we need not to remove the fibrous tissue. You just do the intracondylar osteotomy of the medial plate to open it with a laminar spreader after retracting your superior superficial MCL, and you put a wedge there which you should measure before on the weight bearing X-ray, and put with a tomofix kind of plate or a medial locking plate with the uppermost screw like a raft and lower three screws. You can get away with single plate even in the revision, and you can restore the slope also, which should not be reverse slope if you are putting a medial or endomedial plate. So this in the revision also needs a medial plate. I will not personally put a late posterior plate or posterior medial plate in this scenario, even after the delayed presentation.
Well, actually speaking, we went for the complete excision of the non-union. We just put the bone graft, perfused bone graft, because there was a lot of collapse and there was a lot of gap after we removed the fibrous tissue. And since we put a lot of bone graft, tricortical bone graft, and one plate was not fixing the posterior part of it, and therefore we had to put another plate to support it and buttress even the bone graft apart from the condyle fragment.
Sir, actually, if we understand the biology, the fibrous tissue is created at a site where there is a soft tissue interposition mostly. This fibrous tissue which has been created is because of instability, because the primary surgeon has just put two or three screws. Because of that, there is a continuous toggle while weight bearing. Because of the continuous toggle, the cancellous bone collapses and converts into a fibrocancellous tissue, which we call as a fibrous. So we don't need to remove that in these medial condylar fractures actually. We just open it, put a tricortical graft. A tricortical graft will very well give you a lateral or posterolateral or posteromedial cortex, as well as you buttress it, so you can support it with the hardware there also. So if you go by literature, if we remove the fibrous tissue, we create a more dead space here.
Yeah, that's what it happened actually speaking, and we had to put some lot of bone grafts, and to support up that bone graft, we had to put another plate. And you are right, but you know, you cannot take a second, third chance. The patient has no third chance. So if you have opened it, you have to go wholeheartedly, just do all the things so that patient doesn't come to you or anyone else for third attempt.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Kuldeep. I have to interrupt. Sorry. I think we should move on to next case so that we can discuss more and more cases. So Arun, sir, are you ready with your case?
Hemant, yes, my talk is ready.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Kishore,
stop sharing his screen first.
Yeah, sure.
So now I welcome Arun sir, our Rosa president, to present his case.
Okay. So good evening once again. I'm audible and visible, no? Everything,
yes,
my slide
yes,
is
sir.
Yeah.
No,
yes,
clear,
yes,
clear,
sir.
Loud
yes.
And clear.
So a lot has been talked about the tibial plateau fractures and everybody is thinking. My talk is something different than tibial plateau, as it is focusing on the proximate tibial fractures, no doubt about it. So it's a common fracture in high velocity trauma and may have intra-articular association with it. The main important point in these proximal tibial fractures are associated soft tissue injuries, which includes the severity of swelling, visible contusions, location of blisters. These are very important points when we are treating these proximal tibial fractures. If you don't tend to look at them, you tend to miss them. If we don't anticipate, you land up in problems. Then classification of fractures and proper imaging techniques, as my previous surgeons have told the importance, and then associated ligament and meniscal injuries. And the main concern of our treatment would be the restoring the limb alignment and the treatment, various treatment modalities for these fractures, and the proper assessment of limb threatening complications should be known to a person or index surgeon who is treating these fractures. So let's come to the case directly. So this is my case. This is a 40-year male who's a farmer by occupation, who had a road traffic accident, and he sustained a fracture of a proximal tibia, which was Gustilo's Anderson type 3A fracture. He was hemodynamically stable patient with no comorbidities. This was his preoperative X-rays. This X-ray has a badly comminuted extra-articular fracture of proximal 1/3 tibia. It was a high-velocity trauma. Now, what should we do? What should be the further plan of action? Anybody?
I think Hitesh can take it.
Hitesh, can you take? So I would like to interact with everybody who is doing it. So let's see what Hitesh has to say. Hitesh, are you there?
Yes, sir. I'm here, sir. Hello, sir. I'm audible.
Yes.
Yeah,
sir.
Yeah.
Yes, yes. Yes, there you go.
Yes, sir. My first choice will be, sir, in this primary laser ring fixator, because that we can do in...
What investigation you would like to have? If you would like... Are you satisfied only with the X-ray, or you would like to...
Yes, sir. X-ray is...
good enough?
Yes, X-ray is good enough. Patient has good vascularity. Then it seems only extra-articular fracture, so X-ray is good enough.
Right. So you would like to go for fixator.
Anything else, Hitesh? Nothing else. So would you like to have traction views or not?
Sir, that laser fixator we can do early, means at the first day itself we can do, maintaining alignment and with traction, and we can put the laser fixator.
So, because it was a Gustilo's Anderson type 3A, we can have a treatment plan. We go for an X-fix or a debridma, or X-fix with Elizarov monorail or a uniplanar fixator, or should we go for internal fixation with debridma? Internal fixation with plating, either single plate, dual plate, X-fix plus plating, or I am kneeling. So, what should be the treatment plan? Anybody?
Yeah,
I think
Dr.
this is a
Dr. Nandkishore.
Yes, sir, I want to know the neurovascular status of the patient, and it seems to be badly
neurovascular. Yeah.
It seems to be badly comminuted fracture, so there are chances of compartment syndrome also. So first we have to consider that the neurovascular structure should be intact, and there should be no compartment. Then we have to go for final fixation. And it depends on whether there is no blisters, blabs have resolved. Then it is better to go for osteosynthesis. And for such kind of fracture, I think there are two options. One is intramedullary fixation with multiple screws in the bicondylar screw, that is expert nail, or we can go for dual plating.
Okay. So what is the status of soft tissue? In such a fracture, most important point to consider is status of the soft tissue, because it's a very severe trauma. We have to give time for the soft tissue to heal. So and so to bring into the situation where we can decide how to. So I think initially we should span it. And what is the status? So, soft tissue status.
So what is, is it compound closed fracture, sir?
It is a gastroendocin type 3A. That is what I said. Yeah, it's an open fracture.
Yeah, you have to respect the tissues first. So you have to span it, plan the debrima, and then bring the soft tissue into granulation state and good healing potential or flap and whatever you decide. And then we can further plan. This is the primary stage. I'm not in favor of the primary internal fixation.
So, sir, if it is compound grade 3A, then first is the debridement, and then after that we can go for a fixator or plating or needle. It depends on the condition of the wound, how it is looks. If you think that the wound is good after debridement, it looks good. If we are confident that we can put plate and there will be no infection, then we can directly go for plating or nailing. Or if we think that the compound fracture pattern.
Okay.
Then we can go for X-fix.
Okay, doctor. So Dr. Nandu and Dr. Pratik are saying to span and then wait, and Hitesh is saying for primary. So, and Dr. Yeah. Kuldeep, you want to say differ something?
So, sir, if you this is a compound grade 3A, it is already compound. So compartment syndrome is out of question. Now, once it is a high grade injury, there should be an outer contamination into the wound. So my approach will be to do a thorough pulse lavage and a debrima, a gentle debrima and a pulse lavage. I am practicing for past 2 years doing pulse lavage. And, you know, we keep ETO pulse lavage ready. We do a lot of pulse lavage and these fractures respond well. And then I will personally do a hybrid kind of fixator in this, because the medial plateau is in varus. And the comminution, if you look carefully, is on the medial cortex. So this fracture needs a varus correction by alignment, because if you don't correct varus, in spite of union, your patient will go in early secondary OA. So hybrid fixator has two olive wires, and we have a good opportunity technically to correct a varus in hybrid fixator and Elizaro. Because I am not well versed with Elizaro, I treat these fractures with hybrid fixator. And in hybrid, sometimes these patients respond well and they start showing callus in 2.5, 3.5 months. I continue them on weight bearing on hybrid itself and remove the hybrid at 4, 5, or 6 months maximum. But if they are not showing the callus significant, then in stage two, these fractures needs medial plating. They don't need lateral plating, because this combination will bring your lateral plate in stress. And if your patient don't throw callus early, your plate will fail. So they are the most risky fractures to plate laterally. Although it unites, but sometimes when they fail definitely.
So, what we did was, we did debrima with pin traction. We kept this patient on a pin traction till the wound became clean. And then we planned, after 7 days, we planned it for internal fixation with the proximal lateral tibial plate. As contrary to what Dr. Kuldeep has said, and we had done this lateral tibial plate and tried to reduce the medial fragment with a screw. And as Dr. Babulkar has said, we had tried to put a Kelka screw or a strut screw as well. So do you think this plate is adequate, the length of the plate, the working length, and...
Shushit, sir, your comments.
Lot of comments. So let's start from day one. Compound fractures depends on how aggressive and what seniority level surgeon is doing the debridement. That will decide whether we are doing X-fixing it or internal fixation it. Now, slowly we have moved from external fixation to more and more internal fixation. We have moved from a lousy debridement to a more and more aggressive debridement and debridement and debridement. Your aggression of debridement will support early and better internal fixation. Early and better internal fixation will guarantee you better stability. This kind of a fracture with a lot of comminution is craving for better stability, better fixation, better internal fixation. We have seen all these years, if you put external fixator on, the whole thing gets delayed, including period to remove external fixator, including period for bone healing, including discomfort to the patient to get back to work. So if you give good debridement, if you give early internal fixation, it's better. Okay, so that point is over. Now, what is good debridement? So again, 5 years back, 10 years back, we used to use pulse lavage, and I completely agree with the earlier speaker. Pulse lavage was absolutely an in thing. And we used it left, right, center. Then we realized that actually with high pressure pulse lavage, we are pushing the bacteria which is sitting on the surface. We are pushing the contaminated fragments inside. So now last 3-4 years, all over the world, grade 3 open fractures are to be debrided with low pressure, only saline wash. Repeated wash, but do it very gently with low volume, no aggression of the force, no pulse lavage. So that is done. Compartment syndrome will not occur. Compound fractures, comminution, don't worry about compartment syndrome. It can occur theoretically, but chances are less. Plate fixation, always two plates. Comminution, always two plates. Much longer plate laterally, smaller plate medially. Working lid, not good enough. Those two fragment screws, very near to comminuted fragments, not good because they are actually making comminuted fragments more devitalized. We want to maintain, even if compound, we want to maintain those comminuted fragments intact. We don't want to pierce them with screws. So take your plates longer. Now, because we are using long plates, because we are putting screws away from comminution, you throw in one more plate to make it biomechanically strong, because with comminution, with longer plate, this plate will fail in varus. So that's my take. I think I summed up enough about this.
So I agree to Dr. Shushrut regarding the pulse lavage. I also read a paper where it said that if you are using a pulse lavage, you are actually inserting the bugs inside. So one should not go for the pulse lavage in all these open fractures. So we debrided and we planned to fix it up, and we did this thing 3 months post-op. We did not use a medial plate, thinking that because it's an open fracture and doing dual plating would do more harm than. So we avoided that and planned that we would be doing a second stage surgery.
Yeah.
So this was 3 months post-op. Will it unite or it needs an intervention now?
I think it's failing. And as earlier said, because it's failing in virus, and the plate is under the stress. Already looks like that it will go into the, it might fail, it will go into the non-union. So according to me, it's 3 months post-op, and
yes,
it's time to intervene, because already patient wants to wait, be a, you know, this is not the stage that we should come to mobilization. So it's a time to intervene, I think.
Okay. So this was the second surgery we did. We opened up and we found that the implant is stable, and we thought of avoiding a second plate, and we did a bone graft, thinking that it will unite, and we avoided a medial plate. Any takes on that?
This earlier plate, what you did for earlier plate, did you?
No. So the plate was same. We did not do anything, only bone grafted.
Sir, the same? Bone behaves sometimes very, you know, unexpectedly. So this may unite, but biomechanically speaking, this should fail.
Yeah. So, but what we thought was, like, you know, we tried to reduce the medial fragment, as said, no, because the medial combination would always give a varus and would always lead to a failure. But when we opened up and we saw that the medial column was almost united, so we thought of avoiding that medial plate and we put a graft over there. So this is now 2 months post-op, second surgery. Signs of union can be seen. If you see, the union has started. So this was final follow-up after 1 year, though it united, but with a mild varus. Any takes on that?
So my question to Arun, sir,
you are lucky, sir.
Would you do the same today?
No. So that is what I said. That is what I said, that when we opened up and we planned for a second surgery for doing a medial plate, we saw that this screw, which was fixing the medial fragment, was almost a united. It was, there was no play over there. And so we thought of doing only a bone graft and come out.
Sir, if you see, since the beginning, after your first surgery, if you measure a hip, knee, ankle axis, it is in varus from day one. Because the medial fragments are already overlapping. If you see the medial cortex, your medial fragments, if they are overlapping, means you are in varus. Number one. Number two, if you want to use one plate, as I stressed, these proximal metaphyseal combinations, you should try to plate medially if you want to use single plate. No issues. Even medial with single medial plate, they give wonderful results. But you should use a strong plate when you're using a medial plate, like something like, you know, T-locking kind of plate or a good 4.5 mm strong plate. So lateral plate with these proximal combinations, more on medial cortex, usually behaves the way it has behaved. That is the normal way. And you know, with this varus, patient at times they are not satisfied and they keep visiting the other surgeons. And then there is no way out also for them.
I would suggest when you revised it, that time there was an option to remove this plate and put the nail inside. That would have been much better mechanically. You would have
We are not talking about putting a nail or plate. We are talking about varus. And varus.
Yeah.
So it is definitely a varus. It is varus which will give you, see, the bone has to unite. Bone will unite if we have treated the soft tissue well. Bone will unite even with a varus. But the thing which will keep our patient unsatisfied and maybe in pain is a varus. So nail will not solve the problem. Even after the second, when they did bone grafting, if this patient
talking about correcting the varus itself and fix it with a nail. Varus is not at all acceptable. So medial plate was primary thing, but if I'm giving an option, when there was a decision to put a graft, that time itself the lateral plate would have been removed and correct the varus, centralize it, and then put a nail. Just a sort of fixation. Alternative. You've been muted. Kuldeep, you've been muted.
Hello. So coronal plane deformities, it is difficult to correct coronal plane deformities. It is difficult to do it with axial loading implants like nails. You have to use surface implants when you are correcting coronal plane deformities. And it's a medial coronal plane deformity. So better implant is using a medial plate after correct. This would have given the same result and probably would have been given a better mechanical and life to the knee.
So lateral had to be removed that time.
Yeah, point well taken. But, you know, we were afraid that removing this implant and putting the graft over there, doing an osteotomy.
And, no, sir. It does not need osteotomy, sir.
Kuldeep ji, just a minute. Katta, sir, your final words and then we can move on to the next case.
Yeah.
Dr. Sushrut wants to say something, so we want the conclusive remarks from him. So, okay, for satisfaction, what you would like to do?
I think it was easy to put a longer medial plate when we thought of a delayed union or probably a non-union. Doing by MIPPO would not hamper the soft tissue. Only one medial plate is not good enough. It is a hugely unstable situation. It will need bicolumnar fixation if we are considering a surface implant and of a varying length. So a longer lateral plate and a shorter medial plate, just two screws proximally, two screws distally, medial plate is good enough to take care of this collapse. This is not from day one, Arun sir. This has progressed as he started weight bearing. So day one, you were right. It was absolutely a good axis maintained. As the patients walk, the comminuted fragments tends to collapse. The plate tends to bend, not break, and fracture heals. It has healed. We have seen so many patients where they heal in varus. The problem is today's patient doesn't accept this varus at the fracture site. So as we go along, better science, better technology, better demanding patient, we need to probably consider doing dual plating in such patients.
Yeah.
So still, can we consider correcting the deformity, sir?
Now forget still, what? Not demanding, let him go.
If demanding?
No, if demanding, no. Of course, you will have to do a high tibial osteotomy kind of a thing medially.
From last two cases, we have learned the medial condylar fracture or medially comminuted extra-articular fractures. We must careful about the varus deformities when the patient start walking or weight-bearing. So be careful, treat them, be aware of varus. Thank you. So we should move forward for another case.
Hemanji, the next speaker.
Okay, so Dr. Kuldeep, you will present your depressed fracture case. Dr. Kuldeep, please present your case.
You can unmute
Dr. Yes, Kuldeep. Yes. Just hold on. Share the screen.
I think just before you start, I think we'll have more discussion and less of theory so that we can take up more cases.
Yes.
Are you ready, Dr. Kuldeep, or shall we take Dr. Pratik's case?
Doctor, you can take Dr. Pratik's case. I'll just take after this, after her.
Okay. After. Dr. Pratik, go ahead, boss.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Yeah. I'll just take.
Yes, Dr. Pratik, just to introduce Dr. Pratik.
I think.
Goel, sir, is in consultant in Durlabji Hospital in Jaipur. So, Dr. Pratik, you can start with your case.
Okay. Yeah. Good evening, everyone. So, I'll just go through my case. This is a case of 44-year-old male which met with a road traffic accident and injured his left lower limb, and his distal neurovascular status was intact. Swelling was obvious, which was present, and there was no fracture business. So, this is the fracture x-rays. So, preliminary x-ray on day one with moderate swelling. And so, I just like to know how to proceed further. definitely it's a bicondylar fracture and has a lot of comminution, so CT is required. So instead of asking, I just proceed with the CT scan. So anybody want to decide what to do? Moderate swelling, no blisters, soft, not very hard. Another views of CTs. Any take on this? Rahul sir, what you would like to do?
This is a CT is quite illustrative. Can we have clinical picture, please, of the limb?
No.
I think he said there are no blisters. Yeah, it's a close injury. No fracture.
Okay.
Yeah, moderate swelling, soft limb, distal neurovascular state is perfect, intact.
This is CT scan is quite illustrative. It's a definitely severely comminuted fracture of both the columns, wherein the medial column is a single large piece along with very little comminution, along with lateral comminution and a middle column, which is also comminuted. So, in this case, I would like to, as Dr. Shushrut sir guided, and I would like to go for the medial fixation first in this. Definitely two or three plates, but first will be a medial approach, posteromedial approach, and fix the medial fragment anatomically as far as possible, and then decide on table and probably go for anterolateral plate, a long plate. So maybe rough plate or
so. We mean to say, so that moderate swelling, we'll wait for a few days, 4 or 5 days, and put on few medication, and then decide on going direct for a bicondylar kind of plating arrangement. We can decide according to the fracture. So I'll go forward as you stated correctly. There is a medial fragment, posteromedial fragment, and medial fragment which is large. Little bit displaced, so latching. So what is the fixation plan? Fixation plan is bicondylar plating. Approaches means depending upon posteromedial approaches and anterolateral approaches, that these are the medial fragments and lateral part is most of the combination. Which implant to choose? We have fragment specific implants nowadays. Tips for reduction. We all know how to we saw beautifully as Shushrut sir and Dr. Kashyap told us. How to punch and all the sequence of reduction and fixation. We already know that medial we have to fix and posteromedial plate has to be as posterior as positive. So screw direction from posterior to anterior and not in in our way of lateral fixation. So I used typical posteromedial and anterolateral approaches respectively, and to reduce posteromedial fragment, stabilize with the posteromedial plate and followed by reducing lateral fragment with proper instrumentation. So this is on traction view on the table. I first elevated the medial fragment and put a posteromedial plate holding the posteromedial fragment. And this is that plate quite posterior and holding the fragment there. And here I am just elevating the lateral part with different instrumentation. And this is the final fixation on the table with the lateral plate, and this is the post-op. Fracture is definitely united, and here I was lucky that I got good alignment and all buttressing of all the fragment nicely. This is, I will show you some clinical pictures. Flexion is inhibition. He can squat. He can sit cross leg. And SLR doesn't matter. So any add-ons, any further suggestions, someone would like to do something different. Hemant, would you add something?
So very nice result, Dr. Pratik sir. Anybody wants to disagree? Kashyap sir, Arun sir, Kishore sir, Babulkar sir.
It is really a very good end result of the patient, and all the principle which were said by Sushil Babulkar sir has been nicely followed. Little bit, if you just want to, you know, be critic, actually, otherwise there is nothing to criticize in this. Maybe little virus we might see, but that's not a clinical issue. what happens whenever you see a lateral tibial condylar fracture, split depression, with the lateral part which is extruded say 7-8 mm or more, there is always a chance of lateral meniscocapsular separation and meniscus going into the fracture. So it is right that we need to put a first medial plate, but I often start my case with the lateral incision. I start my case with the lateral incision, retrieve the meniscus which is gone inside, and then I do my medial job, and then I again go to the lateral. So I actually work on the both the side with the supine approach. But this is all in all, it is a wonderful result of a case.
Rightly said.
Thank you, sir.
You must have checked the meniscus, medial meniscus, right? Like you said by so you did with the submeniscal approach, or you must have checked the meniscus, medial meniscus.
Yes.
Sorry, lateral meniscus.
This is the
sir. Is there
the meniscus Kashyap is a basic these days?
Dr. Kashyap, can I ask you? Do you have any role of arthroscopy in this? In case you want to check,
I do arthroscopy. So there is a very small subset of patient of a lateral tibial plateau fracture, which are contained. Contained means there is no wall fracture.
Okay.
So there are one or two cases with a posterolateral depression, but there are no major wall fractures. Then we can go with the scope inside and then push a punch with that. But actually, practically speaking, putting a setup of a scope and IITV is very much cumbersome. Those cases which actually you can do arthroscopically, you can do very easily with IITV and the standard approach. And that doesn't, you know, add anything to the patient other than just having a sense of, you know, fancy satisfaction.
Yes.
A small subset of a contained lateral tibial condylar fracture where the wall is not disturbed. Because what happens when there is a wall disruption, a lot of extrusion of fluid comes.
Fluid.
So you are racing with the time.
Yeah. Correct.
One thing
I want to add, sir. Dr.
Rahul.
Pratik.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, Dr.
Katta. Yeah, I want few things to be addressed by you for the younger surgeons. In such kind of cases, sir, although your case has a very good result and you have done it very nicely, but sometimes the difficulty is how to maintain the width of the condyles, because you are putting the locking plate. Sometimes under compression or the over compression or the trapdoor effect. So how to prevent that? The first point you have to address. And the second thing is sometimes when these such kind of fracture, there is a subchondral void. So how to decide when to put a graft in such cases? So these are the two important questions to be addressed by the senior faculty members.
Yeah. So 2 points, sir. Yeah, please. Kashyap, please, sir.
No, if Susurat sir can highlight on the bone grafting, the need of bone graft, sir.
So I think more and more we are using raft screws. We are shying away from putting bone grafts. Unless and until that defect is more than 8 to 10 millimeter, and we lift up the whole fragment and my raft screws are not going subchondrally to support. Now the newer raft plates, this is an old design of Zimmer. The newer raft plates have variable angle freedom also up to 25 to 30 degrees. So they run parallel to each other, but they also target the posterolateral corner or anterolateral corner. And from lateral side, they go on the anteromedial corner and the posteromedial corner. So they are running parallel to each other, but they are not only in one plane, which is this narrow zone, but also going towards the corners. So that's a new design, and they have given the variability in this. Good question of width. Unless and until you compress it adequately, and before compressing it adequately, if you put the locking screws, that compression will never occur because you are putting locking screws. So you are going to just hold it as you have compressed. So what I do is I put an independent cancellous screw with a washer, compress it, and then if at all you want this raft screw, then push it. Why this width, this increased width of tibial plateau occurs is If you see that fracture line is more medially or more laterally on the weight bearing zone, then the meniscus entrapment issue occurs. But if it is in the intercondylar area, one or two of those tiny intercondylar comminuted fragments get entrapped and they get rotated. And there is no way, if that rotator fragment is there, you can compress it any further. So the only way is to physically go and drag them out. Is it worth it? It's not worth it. You will be surprised, even with this 2 millimeter of increased width, up to 2 millimeter, 3 millimeter maximum, our patients will tolerate this increased width, but don't go beyond. Don't accept beyond 3 millimeter of increased width. How do you see it? You take a good proper AP view and see the femur and the those two axes, femoral condyle and the lateral tibial point, medial tibial femoral condyle and the medial tibial point, and compare the increased width. Don't worry about it too much. But yes, when you put the lateral locking plate and compress it, that's it. You will lock it in whatever position you have reduced that. We are going away from putting a lot of grafts if you use raft plates. If you don't use raft plates, if it's a singular punched collapse of tibial plateau, you need to elevate that punched fragment, then probably you are better off pushing some iliac crest bone graft there, or bone composites block of bone to avoid morbidity.
What about can I add one or two things? Yes, sir.
Yes, sure.
What about the over compression?
So, the one thing is, we need to have a large pelvic clamp for a bicondylar compression. So, I always keep that large pelvic clamp in the set of bicondylar fracture, because you can very well compress both the things. But what care you need to take is when you give that compression over the bone, there are chances that the clamp goes inside. So once you put your plate on either side, and if you can match the trajectory, you put your clamp through the plate holes and then you compress it. Second thing for bone grafting, you need to see what is the subchondral bone which is there with the depressed fragment. So if we have a, say, 7, 8 or 10 mm subchondral bone along with the articular cartilage, our raft screw can actually traverse to that and that can fix. But in a many of the osteoporotic patients, what happens, when you elevate, there is a very thin, flimsy subchondral bone is left. So if you put your raft plate, actually your cartilage plate is sitting over the raft plate only without having a bone fixed to it. So those are the cases where I put graft. So typically, elderly patient with a lot of compression and less of a subchondral bone. And I also have a small trick of harvesting a graft from distal femur. You take it, there is a coring out which is available, and you can, with the same incision, you can take two nice, very good pegs from the distal femur, and within a 2 minute you can get those and you put under the lateral tibial condyle. So sometimes in some borderline cases we can go away without going to iliac crest.
Very nice point of putting the clamp through the plate. I use a Synthes gun which comes. You keep on triggering it and it compresses nicely through the plate. So you apply the plate and it catches hold both the cortex, and you apply pressure and it compresses the fracture along with the plate. So it's very good point, Dr. Kashyap. So easy to manage such cases according to them.
So very nice result, Dr. Pratik. And
thank you, sir. I was lucky. I mean,
nicely done, definitely.
So I stop here. Thank you.
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Pratik. So now I invite Dr. Kuldeep Nathavat, who is a great face of ROSA even nationally, and has a keen interest in knee, so to give his talk and depressed fractures case-based discussion. Before you start, Dr. Kuldeep ji, I'll ask Dr. Rahul Katta, sir, how long we can go?
Half an hour more.
Speed up, maybe maximum half an hour.
So, Dr. Kuldeep, it's my request and all to other speaker also, we need to be precise and we want to be case-based discussion only, less theory.
Thank you, Dr. Hemant, and all the invitees, Dr. Rahul Garg and Rosa, office bearers, to give me this chance. And I should thank our eminent faculties for throwing a very good light over these complex fractures, you know. So I'll be dealing with the most common fractures, which is Schartz's type 3 and Schartz's type 2. As Dr. Kashyap was telling, that there are pure depressed fractures and mostly seen in elderly people because of osteoporosis and when they fall into the, you know, valgus loading. So if you see, there are two subset of patients and we do encounter these fractures in young also. So 24-year-old young male, you can see there is a pure depressed fracture, and there is a 60-year-old lady who is having already some OA changes and, you know, pure depressed fractures. So in these two subset of patients, we really need to approach them in some different way, as we were discussing need of bone graft and all that. So when there is a young patient, we have good bone stock and now raft plates are available. So we can always, you know, plan ourselves and put a raft plate after elevating them. But in elderly, we should be prepared for bone graft also. As Dr. Kashyap has told, so I also practice that and I keep an oat set with me, because osteochondral allograft transfer set have advantage of, you know, harvesting a cylinder corticocancellous graft from the anterolateral edge of the distal femur from the same incision extension. So in these two cases, the ideal thing is to do with the anterolateral submeniscal arthrotomy approach, and we do them under vision and we lift the meniscus. Most of the time, the lateral meniscus is torn and intruded into the joint. And once we tag the lateral meniscus, it gets extruded. And we can restore the articular surface under vision. Most of the times, they have an anterior hairline crack also. We can use that crack after identification with superiosteal dissection. And we open it like an open book, put a small blunt instrument and hammer it out. And a beautiful way, you can physically see how it comes out and pops out, and you can restore the convexity of the lateral plate too. And this is how you can elevate and fix it, with some meniscal arthrotomy approach. Similarly, type 2 Schartz's fractures, these fractures have depression, and usually we do have a very much visible and obvious split in these fractures, you know. So here you can see a young 32-year-old male, close injury, soft tissue and compartment is normal, but he has a depressed fracture, and CT is must for these fractures actually. And if you see CT scan carefully, the posterior lateral, what talk Dr. Kashyap has given, these fractures should get amenable with those kind of approach. But as we know that we can approach them from anterolaterally also. So this articular surface, which is purely depressed on the posterior lateral side, needs an elevation and then fixation with something like raft plate. So here is a submeniscal arthrotomy approach video. If you can see here, once we expose with the anterolateral approach, we put a needle and see in the IITV and identify a level of transverse incision, arthrotomy incision, and we can do from posterior to anterior lateral arthrotomy. And what I am doing here, I am doing a submeniscal, subperiosteal exposure from a small knife. And if you can see there, here is a anterior crack, you know. And this needle is to find out the level of my transverse arthrotomy incision. After this, we can extend this arthrotomy posteriorly. And once we do that carefully, we put an Ellis forceps, and if you'll be able to see the intruded lateral meniscus here. If you see here, this lateral meniscus is intruded and torn from the capsular meniscal junction. So once in the olden days, we used to do this blind by temp method. You know, we never used to address this meniscal issue. And sometimes our patient do used to present with a complaint of locking. And then we tag this meniscus from anterior to posterior. We actually weave this. So we use a kind of vicryl suture, a thick vicryl suture number 10, And you know, later on use the same vehicle suture to tie it with a cancellous bone, because the needle which it is having is a kind of OS needle, which usually pierces the cancellous bone very easily. The technique of ligating is more, the technique of tagging the meniscus is more important. As I told you, it is a weaving of the meniscus. So meniscus should not get entangled into the sutures. So you go from downside to upside, and then upside to downside, and then downside to upside, like this. So once you are coming from downside, you have to again go from downside to outside, and then again from outside to inside. If you can see carefully, after putting one or two sutures, these sutures start acting as a retractor, and we can put three or four sutures and retract the meniscus proximally and put a varus force, and we will be able to see the depressed joint there. Usually there is a hematoma at this stage. If we use a syringe of 10 or 20 ml to wash out that hematoma and open this anterior open book very gently, we will be able to see our depressed articular surface at a 360 degree. After putting a varus and proximal retraction of the meniscus, we can even see up to the medial tibial plate too. Here I am trying to show the depressed articular surface, although it is not very much clear, but you will be able to appreciate it in a little. So this is the articular surface,
yes.
And this is the articular surface. I am manipulating with a blunt instrument, and after elevating it with this blunt instrument, I am passing a subchondral wire, just subchondrally wire, to hold it there. And once I pass it medially, I should take it back as medial as possible till the fracture surface here. So this holds the elevated articular surface, and this is a tentative wire which will hold my articular surface and will not allow it to fall it back. And as you can see, the extruded articular surface of the lateral meniscus is lying here. It is retracted. So see, it rotates with the rotation of the drill. You can see there. So you can manipulate and keep the elevation under IITV, and you can keep it maintained there by putting two wires which should be parallel to each other, and then you can close it like this. So your osteotomy kind of thing, your fracture which you have opened like an open book is closed, and then you can pass with a tentative wire and fix it there. This is a video for submeniscal approach, which usually many of us or our junior colleagues which always ask how you do medial lateral submeniscal arthrotomy. So these sutures are very important sutures, and if you can see, the dissection anteriorly should be till the tibial tubercle, because we need to retract the patellar tendon and need to see whole of the lateral articular surface from below the patellar tendon to the posterior lateral corner here, if you can see towards my finger here. So after this, you can even feel and you can even see the elevated articular surface, and then you can little bit extend your incision and put a rough plate here. I'll again share the screen. So this is the picture. How does it looks? If you can see here, these are the depressed articular surfaces, and after elevation, this is how it looks. And this is the closure we do. So the meniscus, the sutures which we use for tagging, usually we can use them for repair also from anterior to posterior in the same way. And this is the post-op X-ray. So that is from my side. So my message is that these split depressed or pure depressed fractures, they needs to be elevated as accurate as possible, because a depression of more than 2 millimeters should not be accepted, and the meniscus should be respected, and submeniscal approach should be practiced by all of us for these fractures, because that not only reduces the IITV exposure, but also gives more confidence to elevate these fractures under vision and fix them with a very, very much and with very good confidence, giving a very good functional outcome to the patient. Thank you.
So Dr. Kuldeep very nicely demonstrated just now submeniscal arthrotomy. So anybody else using a different technique for submeniscal arthrotomy or repair of meniscus subsequently? Kashyap sir or Shushrut sir?
It is almost same as what Dr. Kuldeep has said. The only one or two technical differences what we do is, see, on a lateral meniscus, it is attached to the capsule on outermost surface. The upper capsule is the meniscofemoral capsule. The lower capsule is a meniscotibial capsule. The meniscotibial capsule actually attaches to the lateral tibial plate to say about 4-5 mm below the articular cartilage. So when we do our submeniscal arthrotomy, the leave a small cuff of tissue, say about 4 mm, then you can enter submeniscally, and at the end you can repair directly capsule to capsule so that you don't need to go through the bones. But otherwise this technique is also very good. That's what a small difference which I do.
I think similar thing, meniscus you repair to bone is a better idea, because soft tissue to bone is a better anchorage, number one. Number two is usually the intermediate lateral convex tibial articular fragment gets depressed and gets tilted more towards medially. And if that tilt is more than 45 degrees, so that's 0 degrees, that's 45 degrees and more, then going through the fracture, it is very difficult to lift it up. What I do is, I don't open the fracture site in that case. I create a medial cortical window, just a small nick, use spinal surgery punches of varying sizes to push that tilted fragment go in its desired position. And you are watching from the submeniscal approach whether that fragment is coming up, up or not. And then you just push the lateral fragment. Advantages, because you are not going through the fracture site, your cancellous bone is not going to crush more. So you need to have less amount of graft required, because the entire thing will be pushed. Your raft screws, as Kashyap suggested, will be engulfed in the raft screws. But yes, it's a good technique and nicely done.
So very nicely shown by Dr. Kuldeep. Again, before we move on to the next case, any tips for depressed fractures on the medial side when we need to do submeniscal arthrotomy on the medial side? First yourself,
Dr. Hemant. So I have done three cases of although very rare split depressed medial plate to fractures. There, we should not approach, it is difficult to approach them submeniscally because there is a medial collateral ligament there. So what we can do, we can approach them from the anteromedial window, that is the anteromedial to the medial meniscus. So we take our standard anteromedial arthrotomy approach, what we take in total knee, we take out the sub retropatellar fat and we just retract the MCL, we are able to see it, how much depressed it is. And depending upon the depression configuration, as Dr. Shushrut has said, that if it is medially tilted, he lifts it with the medial window. So how do you approach to lift it? That depends upon how it is depressed. So if it is having a posterior tilt, you need to create a posterior medial window and lift it with a blunt temp. If it is medially tilted, you need to create a medial window. And at times, I keep a small, a dental instrument is there, a very small chamach type instrument. You can put it into the fracture site, into the crater, take it to the as deep as possible, it is subchondral bone, say around 10 to 12 millimeters minimum, and then, jack it. It usually pops it out. and then you can fix it tentatively with K wires, and then according to the fracture configuration, you fix it with the implant which is desired there. So, but submeniscal, it is difficult to reach there. If some of the faculty is doing submeniscal on medial side, I would also be interested and keen to listen to them.
Yes, may I? Yes, split depression type of fracture which occurs on a lateral tibial condyle usually doesn't occur on a medial side. As Dr. Kuldeep said, it is a very rare event. I have also seen only 2-3 cases, and most of them are in anteromedial side. Why? Because the descent dome shape of the lateral and medial tibial plateau. So the lateral tibial plateau is a dome shaped. So when there is a punching of femoral condyle, it goes in like a depressed. But the medial tibial condyle is a concave. So whenever there is a split, it will be a vertical split. So when to do that submeniscal arthrotomy, the one approach which was rightly said by Dr. Kuldeep, anteromedial depression, which is a very rare. But the when I do almost always submeniscal arthrotomy is a coronal fracture of the medial tibial condyle, where your coronal fracture line is actually exiting on the medial side. What happens? We address to the apex only. So we put a plate, match the apex, and in a postoperative X-ray, when you see, there is a step on the medial tibial condyle. So whenever there is a coronal medial tibial condyle fracture, what you can do is you don't have to do submeniscal arthrotomy as we are doing it on lateral side, and we cannot do it also because of a very adherent and very broad superficial MCL. So what we can do is after going to the apex, you palpate your vertical fracture line at the joint. You put your small incision, say about 1.5 centimeter in the line of MCL. So when you put that incision, you will be able to reach to the medial articular cartilage. There you definitely find a step. You just erase little bit, say 4-5 mm MCL on either side, and you have to match your articular cartilage. You can't see the lateral tibial plateau as good as medial, but what you have to do is you have to match the external rim and the apex. So when you do that, then you get 100% reduction in a coronal medial tibial condyle fractures.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. I think we are very short of time. And can we move on to the next case, sir?
Yeah. One more case I think we can take quickly.
Can I present first? I think after me, I'll present quickly. Then after the compound injuries cases, Dr. Anand Kishore and Dr. Edesh's case.
Before you are sharing the screen, the 3 points came with this case of Kuldeep. Number one, for the depressed tibial plateau fracture, direct visualization of the reduction is must. Number two, you have to be through the submeniscal approach, use either a open book method or creating a window to elevate such fractures. And third thing is, if there is a vertical split, always use the plate. Don't rely only on these screws. So I think these are the three key points. So nicely presented. Now you can start, Dr. Hema, your case.
Yes, sir. So this patient was 25-year-old male who's sustained injury in road traffic accident. Straight away showing you the lateral view X-rays, and I don't have a good AP view, so I have shown you the CT scan AP films. The first comments, quick comments from Dr. Pratik. Dr. Pratik is here. Okay, anybody else? Kashyap sir.
Yeah, actually we discuss a little bit about this case on our group.
I'll show you the MRI also. Okay.
Yeah, this is a different kind of injury. This, however, is not a part of the proximal tibial fracture. This is a dislocated knee, which is reduced again. So that's it's a ligamentous injury, along with there are some avulsions of ACL, PCL. There must be a lateral meniscus injury there. So this is a kind of a reduced dislocation of the knee.
Yes, sir. So I'll show you the CT and MRI. We also thought of the same. It looks to be a ACL as well as PCL avulsion with multiple combination. Distal neuromuscular vascular status was normal. So these are the axial and sagittal CT images, which shows multiple fragments and one fragment coming all the way anteriorly outside. This is another section. This is the 3D CT images. Any comments now?
So we need to see on MR also.
Okay, I'll show you the MRI also. So this is the MRI, sagittal image, and this is the coronal image. And we see there is a bone fragment coming out all the way here. I'll show you the report also, MRI.
Dr. Hemant, these cases, I do ask my radiologist for while he gives me a CT scan films, he should give me on the top image of TBI in a 3D reconstruction, you know.
After
minusing the femur, so we will be able to locate where exactly this fragment has flipped from. Whether it is a plateau fragment or it is a, you know, Owl's fragment of the ligament.
Yes, I agree to you, but unfortunately, I don't have the over the top subtracted view. But exactly what you said, it is not only the Owl's fragments, there are other plateau fragments also in this.
You can see even the lateral meniscus posterior on is flipped to the anterior aspect.
Yes, yes, yes.
Because there is a very continuous pattern of cases which becomes like this. So where the posterior lateral corner, you get a punch of the bone, a small piece of the bone along with the lateral meniscus comes into the anterior compartment.
Yes, sir. So how should we plan in such cases?
And we need to see the neurovascular status, because this knee dislocation.
Neurovascular status is normal in this case.
What is the clinical status of ligaments? Also how is the knee coronal plane? In coronal plane, how is the knee?
What was the MCL and LCL? That's what.
Let me complete the report.
There must be one of them along with that.
Both MCL and LCR are partially sprained. They are intact. Okay. And on clinical examination also, there is. They seem to be okay. ACL is avulsed. It's a type 4 Mayer-McIver avulsion with comminuted fragments. And lateral meniscus, as rightly pointed out, Kashyap sir, a lateral meniscus is lifted up and it anteriorly displaced. The PCL is also sprained. There is not a complete tear.
So, you know, medial collateral has high grade, more than 50%, you know, periligamentous soft tissue within substance. Where exactly the medial collateral is affected, tibial side or femoral side in the CT, in the MRI?
It's the whole substance. It's not a femoral or tibial.
No, if it is in the whole substance, then we can treat the MCL conservative. We can treat the lateral LCL conservative. And then now we need to, if the periarticular soft tissue, you know, it's a contained type of fracture into the joint. So I will definitely try to put a scope into it. And then we'll see these fragments and lateral meniscus, because lateral meniscus looks to be averse from the meniscocapsular junction, which if I will reposit and repair it with, you know, something like fast fix or 360 fast fix like that. And ACL definitely should be primarily fixed. And I doubt that there is a plateau fragment also there. So if it is, there is a plateau fragment, I will try to reduce it and fix it with the biopins. Because these intra-articular plateau fractures, which are having subchondral bone attached with them, they do get consolidated well when you fix them with a bioabsorbable kind of pins. And if arthroscopically it is not amenable to me, at times it is not, then I will, you know, abandon arthroscopy and will open it with the endomedial approach. And we'll do everything open, including meniscus repair, ACL avulsion fixation, and fixation of the articular surface using biopins. And I will leave the PCL.
Exactly, Dr. Kuldeep. We also did the same thing. We started with arthroscopy. And this is the arthroscopic picture. We see the bone fragment lifting up the lateral meniscus here. And besides this, I don't have the other arthroscopic pictures. You are right. There were plateau fragments also. Mainly there are four fragments besides small comminuted fragments. So I tried to reduce it arthroscopically and I failed. So we did this complete arthrotomy, and this is the picture. So now we fixed it with multiple K wires initially, and later on, we did the lateral plateau fixation with multiple K wires and ACL avulsed fragment with a screw. So this is the post-operative X-ray. Anybody else? You said, Dr. Kuldeep, that you will fix with bio pins. Any other options, sir? Sushil sir, Kashyap sir, what you will use for this?
So it is a very small combination. I don't have access to bio pins. I would like to know from which company now we get bio pins.
Sir, we are having bio pins from Arthrex. Arthrex.
Okay. Yeah, Arthrex has it, sir.
Now, I have addressed these, you know, the 2-3 fractures in these past 12-13 years. And I have realized that these bio pins are quite handy. They are 2 mm pins which are having, you know, self-taping on either side. We can use from either sides like a K wire. And these, because metal or SS K wires, we have to put in the same direction as Dr. Hemant has rightly put. But if this would have been a bio pin, we would have addressed is perpendicular to the cartilage surface, which is actually a direction for fixation. Here, you know, what happens, we try to fix it, although, but then it is not as per the principles of fracture fixation, which should be the perpendicular to the fracture.
Yes, rightly pointed out. So this was our 2 months follow-up. The fracture seems to be start consolidating. We started mobilization after 1 month, and this is the final follow-up at 3 months. So now what next?
These type of injuries quite get stiff often. So once you understand that the fracture is sticky, then manipulation under anesthesia helps a lot.
Okay, sir.
Before doing anything, we need to make this knee supple. Let that not be a full range of movement, but the patient has to be pain-free. There should not be any FFD, and the inflammation should go on. Then only we need to think over anything else in this knee.
Dr. Hemant, at 3 months, I can see that there is almost 30 degree of flexion. So, as Dr. Kashyap has rightly said, that I will try to give some gentle manipulation under anesthesia, patellofemoral as well as the flexion extension. Although I will not do more flexion, more than 70 degree or maybe 80 degree, because at 3 months, I do have a chance of avulsion of my, you know, weak fragments. But definitely, if I reach something around 70, 80 degree of flexion, and also mobilize the patellofemoral joint at 3 months, which should be supple at 3 months, not very much fibrous. And then again, I will subject the patient to CPM postoperatively, control passive motion. And once I get a 90 degree of movement, then probably that is the time to again intervene and look for range of motion. And before this, we should take out these K wires because I believe they should hinder our range of motion because they are on the medial aspect.
Okay. So, only 3 months have passed, and should we go for arthroscopic arthrolysis? Anybody?
Yes. Good option.
That's also an option. But I think if we can do gentle manipulation and little bit range of movement, then we may not need also. But arthroscopic edelosis is also a good option.
Okay, sir. So this is, thank you. I'll not take more time. I think we can take one more case, Katta sir.
It is already too late. Whose case is there?
We have 2 cases pending, Dr. Hitesh and Dr. Nand Kishore Vaishnav. Can we take a quick case?
Who is going to? Another 10 minutes.
Okay, Dr. Nandu, you are presenting? Or Dr. Hitesh?
Yeah, Dr. NK can.
Okay, Dr. Nand Kishore Vaishnav.
So is it visible?
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Very well, sir.
So it is already a long session and each and everything has been discussed. I just quickly share my slides, taking no time. This is a case of upper tibia fracture, compound comminuted bicondylar tibia fracture. The history is 35-year-old male, road accident, pain bleeding from the knee, not able to lift the limb. Wound on the knee, feeling that his leg is freely moving from the knee. So this is the preoperative emergency picture, which is showing that the anterior dashboard injury with the severely comminuted bone fragments coming out of the wound and a large wound. The patient has presented around 10 hours after the injury to our hospital. So this is the preoperative X-ray, which is showing that badly comminuted fracture, bicondylar, more so comminution on the lateral side, as well as the fibular head and fibular neck is also having comminuted fracture. So on examination, the vitals and the all vitals are stable, except some blood pressure is low, and systemic SpO2 level is good. And on systemic examination, there is no head injury, chest injury, or any systemic injury. And on local examination, there is around 15 to 20 centimeters of the lacerated wound on the anterolateral aspect of the tibia, and bone pieces are exposed. Muscle on the lateral compartment of the leg are crushed, and wound is contaminated and skin is degloved. Then the local, in addition to the local examination.
Dr. Nandu, sorry to interrupt. I think you go to the more to the pictures and then we can discuss.
Okay. So distal neurovascular status is good. And it is compound comminuted grade 3B bicondylar fracture tibia without neurovascular injury. And if we classify it Sajatkar classification, then it is diaphyseal and metaphyseal dissociation with intra-articular extension with muscle crushing. So now the planning is, first is the debridement of the wound, then bone fixation by the external fixator, and involvement of the plastic surgeon, hemodynamic management, and prevent the systemic complication like the kidney damage or septicemia, and prevent the wound infection, which is very important in this case. So intraoperatively, we found that the wound is thoroughly washed with hydrogen NS and Savlon and Betadine, and bone fixation was done with the external fixator. And the lateral side of the leg is left open without any pins and rods, so that plastic surgeon work will not hamper. And the articular margin of the upper tibia is maintained using a pin in the metaphyseal region, and the movement of the knee joint is prevented using a pin in the distal femur and attaching it to the rest of the fixator. So this is a intraoperative C-arm picture. It shows that one pin in the metaphyseal area of the tibia, and this is intraoperative picture after the debridement. So this picture shows that two pins are there, one in the distal femur, other one in the upper tibia. And the main rod is attached on the medial side, and the multiple pins are put from medial to lateral side of the tibia, and the lateral side of the wound is laid open. And this is the gastrosoleus rotation flap done by the plastic surgeon. And this is skin grafting done. So post op there is no any systemic complication, movement and pulse of the foot is good. Some wound discharge is settled with the time, and skin graft is accepted, and pin care and local wound care in follow up. So this is post operative X-ray, which shows that the intra-articular line is well maintained, but extra-articular comminution is there. This is post-operative X-ray. And this is the status of wound at 6 weeks. Now, what is next step? When have to remove the fixator? How to do the final bone fixation? Single plate or dual plate? Cast or continuous traction? How to prevent the infection? Bone grafting, single stage or two stage? CT scan before the final surgery? And to consider the range of motion of the knee also in mind.
So, Dr. Hitesh,
so now
how
we
can do it? Can we take Dr. Hitesh?
I think Dr. Hemant.
Yes, sir.
We should have comments from any of the faculty.
Yeah, so I think Hitesh is the only remaining person who has yet to present the case. I think we'll take his comments on this case only.
Sir, can you show the previous slide, sir? Just. Okay, sir. Okay, so he's having some various deformity also, and the fracture is not united. Is it so, sir? That's enough, sir.
Only 6 weeks, Hitesh, and the flap has been done, and it is a temporary scanning.
Okay. And sir, there is flap is good, and there is no discharge.
No list, yes.
Okay, sir. So, okay, sir. Still, I will go with there are still two options with fixed removal, and after that we can do plate or bone graft. But for me, I will do Eligero fixator application, and I will start weight bear, and I will see if there if fracture swelling careless, then I can wait and watch. If there is no sign of healing, then we can do bone graft later on. So this we can do with the Eligero fixator. So because we can start early weight bearing, so there is chances of healing also.
Kuldeep, at 6 weeks, this is the presentation, the X-ray and the clinical picture. So how will you proceed, and what are the key points in this case? So quickly sum up, any one of you.
You know, at 6 weeks, what happens? This is the soft tissue management. Knee is already going to be very stiff at this stage. So first, we have to focus on gaining some movement, which is possible, which can be possible right now. So, and avoiding some other intervention. My one option would be just convert this fixator or to a hybrid fixator. As Kuldeep earlier told, initially also, if we would have applied a hybrid external.
Pratik, net connection is loose. Kuldeep, would you like to intervene?
Yes.
In short, we are running short of time.
Am I audible?
Yeah. Sure.
So the two things are there. At this stage, we need to decide between the definitive bony fixation with the knee range of motion, you know, our AMR2. And definitely when we do fixation, we need to achieve alignment. So at this stage, I will take a call depending upon the soft tissue. If it is not very good in favor of putting internal fixation, then I will definitely do a hybrid kind of fixator. And simultaneously after fixation, I will do a mobilization under general anesthesia so that I can restore a range of motion with hybrid fixator. I can continue weight bearing as well as range of motion. Another thing, if it is not my choice, then I will do a medial plating. And after medial plating, I will again do mobilization under anesthesia and then continue the mobilization under anesthesia. Will not put the patient in plaster because it is 3 months and the fracture should be adhesive at this time. So our aim should be to restore the alignment, to achieve the union, and simultaneously to gain the range of motion. How we do that? Because it is a knee spanning fixator, we have to take it out. So either we have to use a fixator like a hybrid or a Lazaro if somebody is well versed. If it is going more towards infection and soft tissue is not favorable, or internal fixation, then definitely medial plate, because anterolaterally there is a flap. So medial plate is an option. I can slide a plate there, put 2 screws up and 3 screws down, as Dr. Shushrut has said. A kind of biological plating over and above the medial meniscus after retracting the hamstrings, and we can get away with the case, you know.
Okay. So Pratik and you both are basically keen to start the knee mobilization first by modifying the fixation, either continuing the external fixation with the hybrid fixator or go for the internal fixation. Correct. Absolutely agree. Yes. We have to start the movements first. And then if this case goes in the non-union, what are the options left for the fixation, bone grafting, other things? So suppose after 2 months, you see that fracture is not going to unite. So when to intervene, when you want to go for the another fixation or bone grafting. So that is the one question to be answered by one of you.
So non-union, intervention of non-union after doing definitive fixation should not be before 12 weeks at least. We should wait for 12 weeks and then we should take a call whether it needs any kind of bone grafting or any other thing.
So suppose you are converting this in a hybrid fixator and started knee mobilization.
Correct.
So when you want to intervene for the bone union?
So we will try to take a serial X-rays and we'll watch for the union. If there is a consolidation,
we are going towards our aim. But if there is no consolidation, we should wait and ask the patient to bear weight over it. And at 12 weeks, we should decide whether we should do bone grafting with the fixator in situ, or we should convert a fixator into internal fixation and do a bone grafting, but not before 12 weeks.
12 weeks from 6 weeks or 12 weeks in total?
From 6 weeks.
Okay, fine. Anybody disagree with the Kuldeep's opinion?
Same, I agree with this.
Dr. Kashyap or Dr.
I don't have a great experience of managing this open fracture, but this is nicely managed from day one. And the flap also very nicely done. Only thing I would probably have added is an intercondylar screw on day one. That is number one. And the options which were said by Dr. Kuldeep and Pratik are fine. Absolutely, those are the one, two. But if we want to add one, I would probably convert this into Elizarov. And if there is a issue of union at the proximal site, what I do is I will do distal corticotomy and bone transport to heal up the proximal thing. So if I'm worried about infection and I'm not plating it. So rather than bone grafting, I would do distal corticotomy and compress the fracture with the bone transport.
So surgeons who are well versed with the technique of Elizarov can fix any fracture with the Elizarov. So that is true. But it is difficult to learn the Elizarov techniques with all the surgeons. So that is the difficult thing. Otherwise, Elizarov is a very good method of fixation. So Dr. Vaishnav, anything you want to show further or it's over?
No, sir. It is almost done.
So thank you. Thank you so much for a good case. Now, Dr. Hitesh, you can present your case.
Dr. Hitesh, please.
Dr. Hitesh, are you there?
Yes, he has started sharing his screen.
So tell brief history, go to the direct X-ray and the procedure which has been done. In- yeah. You are muted, Dr. Hitesh. Unmute yourself first. Some issues with him?
Unmute.
Hitesh, now you are unmuted. Share your screen and present.
Hello. Sir, visible, sir?
Yes.
So, this is the interarticular fracture. This is the skin condition. I have done indirect reduction and fixed the interarticular fragment with the screws and applied the primary laser fixator. So this is the skin condition after 5 to 7 days. This is the 6 weeks post-op. This is how patient walking with the Elizarov fixator with partial weight bearing. This is patient walking at 4 months. This is the 4 months post-op after the removal of the Elizarov fixator. This is the good alignment, clinical photos. This is the range of movement at the knee at the 4 months. This is how patient is walking.
So my question to Dr. Hitesh, in these blisters condition also we can apply Elizarov?
Yes, sir. I am applying.
Oh, we should wait for 4 or 5 days.
What, sir? So because what I have seen is with reduction of the fragments, there will be no bleeding in internal bleeding will be not there. So during surgery itself, when while fix there is we will see the swelling will be drastically reduced. This is my experience of the last 2 years with the Elizarov fixator, sir. Similarly, I am showing this one other case, extra-articular fracture. This was the skin condition. This is just post-op. This is the condition at the 5th day, sir. This I start immediately mobilize. This is at the 4 months post-op. This is the movement. This is the after removal. Because sir, we are not doing any internal fixation, so with blister, sir, we can do, sir.
So quick comments, Babulkar sir, you want to say something?
Yeah, so I totally agree with Hitesh, and I think I have reserved Elizarov or a hybrid fixator only in those patients with fracture blisters or a bad skin condition beyond 15 to 20 days. So 15 days you are sitting on fracture blisters, 20 days you are sitting on it and they are just not getting healed and it's a huge swelling, then go ahead and do hybrid or Elizarov, and agree with that. Reduction is difficult if there is a huge comminution and bicondylar fragment. Reduction is impossible if it's only coronal fracture. So only a posterior medial fragment or a posterior lateral fragment, Elizarov cannot treat those. So that's where we get stuck. But otherwise, these simpler looking, plain simple bicondylar fracture or extra-articular fractures, it's a good way to bail you out.
Anyone else with any other comments? Pratik, would like to say something?
Good option. Always Elizarov in such fractures where there are no intra-articular extension and it soft tissues condition are very much compromised. From day one, if someone has decided, it's a good option. And from day one, he can put bare weight. He can be mobilized in his knee. But I agree, if suppose there is intra-articular extension, then that reduction is also prime. So what I advocate, that a small incision combined little one or a screw or K-wire fixation to maintain the articular surface and then supplemented with the Elizarov fixation. In that case too is also a good option. So always a good option. I agree.
Anyone else? So rightly said by Dr. Sushrut that if skin condition are not good, let's see that. The methods of extent fixation, either hybrid fixator or Elizarov, the technique well works with the surgeon. So, this is the message with this case.
Out situations.
Yeah. So, Dr. Hemant, would you like to conclude this?
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Hitesh. Nice presentation. Dr. Rahul will conclude.
Yeah, it was a beautiful session, like every time, and always we fall short of time due to our involvement. Great, Dr. Babulkar, to have you back after a long time. It is great, Dr. Kashyap, to have you back on our ROSA platform to show your perils of wisdom as well as guide us through Jodhpur Orthopedic Society and ROSA. All are quite indebted to your talk and knowledge. Dr. Kuldeep, Dr. Pratik, Dr. They have been kind enough, and Arun Boss, Kushore sir, and our younger brothers like Dr. Hitesh and Dr. N.K. Vaishnav, they have also unique cases they have presented. Dr. Hemant has done a good moderating job and made my job very easy. Good to have you always around, and I think Dr. Rahul Katta has given us a good opportunity. All the city chapters are being enhanced to come on a single platform. I think we have had a very nice talk. Anything regarding concluding, Sir Arun, sir, would you like to contribute anything?
Yeah, so
Dr. Rahul will conclude.
Yeah, Dr. So on behalf of Rajasthan Orthopedic Surgeons Association, I'd like to thank especially our guest faculty, Dr. Sushrut and Dr. Kashyap, for their nice presentation. Nice words of wisdom, and all our colleagues or local faculty and the faculty members from Jodhpur city for their nice case presentations and discussions. I'd also like to thank Ortho TV for providing us a good platform to present our work. Thank you so much. Thank you for today. Stay safe. Good night.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Thank you. Good night. Good night,
everyone. Good night, sir.
Good night.
Good night.
Thank you.
Good night, everyone.
Good night, sir. Good night.
Good night.
Good night, sir.
Good night, sir.
Okay, Kuldeep bhai.
Bye, sir.
Nandu ji, Heman ji.
Okay, good job. Sir. Good night. Good night.
Thank you.
Night,
thank Kuldeep. You, Jagan. Kuldeep Jagan, boss. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.